And I sat there, I'm like, am I really sitting at town hall parking lot?
Maybe we have to hire valet parking. Maybe after you start, what you would want to say, I can just start and review what the material is and what the schedule is, what pages things are on. Just so people can sort of organize themselves. Media, right there. Those are three new employees.
Oh, cool.
Julie is our community development director, Jesse. And then we have veterans and full-time veterans, full-time help. New within the last 6 months. Remember those 25 vacancies? So they're all community services as part of public services.
Short ending.
Are you getting any comments as FinCom person about the 40B?
Probably at there for a few hours.
You never know who someone wants to play.
Bad day or?
Spent too much time in the woods.
My husband was like, start running.
Not everybody's open yet.
Last year.
Yeah, I'll have it up in front. I don't remember too, it's when I signed last year.
Sometime in April.
I do, yeah, I'll read those off at the beginning so people can follow.
I saw it there in the parking lot, there's no parking out there.
Both?
Momentarily.
Hey guys.
That was a parking.
Parked it, I was running.
DPW lot has some spaces.
No, I didn't.
Okay, that's where we have the.
Okay, we're gonna call the finance committee meeting to order, please.
Thank you all for coming this evening. Agenda tonight, we're gonna go through the remaining, I guess, four areas in the town budget. We're gonna walk through the warrant, go through minutes, and then any other business that's coming up. So let me turn it over to Bob.
Thanks, Mark. Let me just go through the four areas tonight quickly and give you page references in the budget. We'll also have it on the overhead there. Public services is pages 43 to 56. Gene will discuss that. Public library is next, pages 94 to 100, and Amy's here for that. Public works, Jeff's here, pages 79 to 93. I'll very briefly go over the enterprise funds, page 120 to 142. And just as an outline of what's in the packet for tonight, as opposed to those budgets that are older, tonight, pages 2, 3, and 4 are some back and forth with David and I on worker comp question that he raised last week. Pages 5 and 6 are two of the department's responses to the capital project status question, and we'll fill the rest of those in over the next week or two. The annual town meeting warrant is pages 7 to 23. That's the second set of agenda items for tonight, if you will. And then Mark asked me to put in some things that were shared with the selectmen last night. So I'll just give you a quick rundown. Page 24 is a very rough financial summary since the last override. Pages 25 to 7 are a calendar, a meeting calendar. And in case FinCom doesn't know, and few people were up when it happened, it was about 1 a.m., the selectmen voted unanimously to have an override in October. And they, so they set an election date and they set a special town meeting date last night. Obviously, details to be discussed and arranged. And when we get to the calendar, you'll see that. Pages 28 and 30, there's a look back at a year and a half ago with some things FinCom looked at, and then there's minutes at the end. So I just wanted to give you that update. Mm-hmm. And Gene's now ready to start talking about public services. And the hot seat is right in the middle.
Sorry, and Bart, do you mind sending these electronically to that, like the spreadsheets?
Sure.
Those are great.
Okay.
Yep. Obviously put a lot of work and research into those.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
I have a three-page summary of my budget of comments, but I thought that was probably too long and not what this board is terribly interested in, so I'll spare you the minutia. And I'll talk generally about the Department of Public Services. I'm not sure how familiar everyone on the Finance Committee is with our department, but I think the narrative pretty clearly states that, you know, it's one of these everything departments, everything being in the services realm. About a year and a half ago, we did some tweaks to the organization of the department, and we created two assistant department heads, and they're here tonight, so I'd like them to just raise their hands. John Feudo is the assistant department head. He's the director of community services, and Julie Mercier is fairly new. She's been on board since about the 1st of December, and she's the community development director. So it's been a great model for us to work a little bit smarter, having them as backup for me, and also having them be pretty hands-on with the divisions that fall under them. So they each have four divisions, which is very fair. That worked out very nicely. And John has all of the divisions related to the community services side. So that's human and elder services, veteran services, recreation, and public health. And there are folks here from all of those divisions as well. And then Julie has building, planning, conservation, and historical. So even though it's neatly separated, there's a lot of collaboration. So human and elder services collaborates a lot with health, collaborates a lot with building. And that's really the intent of having a department organized the way public services is organized, that we're kind of a one-stop shop for the public, as well as a very collaborative group that can communicate very easily because we sit pretty proximate, or we work very much in sync with each other and meet pretty regularly. So I'm very pleased with the way it's organized, and I think that we squeeze every bit we can out of our resources that way. And then in FY16, we had some upgrades. For a while there, we had lots of part-time division heads, which made it a little tricky. And so in FY16, almost all of the division heads were upgraded to full-time. So we have a full-time veteran services officer, a full-time health agent, a full-time conservation administrator. The only one that is not full-time is the human and elder services administrator, but that position is augmented by a full-time nurse advocate. So we really have had a pretty robust opportunity to expand a little bit more into our capacity. And the regional services agreement that we used to have with Melrose, that has not been renewed in FY17. So it's staffing here in Town Hall, and we had a little bit of a opportunity in the last contract year to have a plan reviewer, and that's one of the positions I'll talk about that we don't have in this budget. So we've hired about seven positions in the past
whatever, in FY16, but in the last 6 months. So that's the veteran services officer that I mentioned, and he's here. Kevin Bowmiller, if you want to raise your hand. He's been a great resource helping us get out and make sure we're reaching out to the right population and making sure that those that are entitled to benefits are the ones getting the benefits and making sure if there's something going on that we need to address, then we do it. So that's been a big, big help. The health agent is here as well, Steve DeLauro. And again, we had that regional model before, and now we have a full-time health agent. It's just giving us that much more ability to be responsive and be on top of things. And we also have a public health nurse. The position was vacant for a while. That's part-time, but we filled that over last summer, and that's worked out really well. We kind of right-sized it. It's 16 hours a week, same as Melrose, same as a lot of the other communities that are similar to us. So that's working very well. And I mentioned the nurse advocate. That was another position that had been vacant for a while, and it's a full-time position. And that's been, again, another great resource. The most vulnerable population you can imagine that she's dealing with over at the senior center. And then, of course, having our new CD director. So that position was vacant for a while, and I drank a lot of coffee during that period. still drink a lot of coffee, but it's been great to have that position filled. That was a rough one. So you can imagine that was pretty time consuming to get all that going, but we're very pleased that it's there. It's interesting, the CD director and the health agent each took between 3 and 4 months to hire. So we were without for that long, which is not fun. So that's basically kind of what's going on. I guess the only other thing I wanted to mention in terms of the department and the staffing is that we do have a model of all of our inspectors are part-time, and we have a variety of inspectors. We think this is a good model. It saves $30,000 at a minimum, probably higher. My building inspector and I have this argument all day long. But we save on the benefits and, you know, vacation time and all that. But what it really, for me, what I am really happy about is I feel like it's deeper coverage, having all of those people available. They're all, my three building inspectors are all retired. They've all led building departments. They've all been commissioners of buildings, the official title. And so they're really knowledgeable and really deep. And they love coming to work. So that's worked out really well. One of the key reasons why that works so well, a couple reasons. One, we have technology. We're using the View Permit, the software program that helps us work really smart. And so anytime this sign off by conservation or whatever, it's all done electronically, and everyone has access to what's going on. So it's really a great tool. But in addition, we have a superstar administrative assistant. She's a senior administrative assistant, and she does a great job. And she basically is an expediter in getting permits out. If anyone's ever met Kim, you know, she's the glue that keeps it all together. So I think that's sort of a good part of our story that I just wanted to share. A couple of other quick things, and then we'll talk numbers.
Sure.
Yep. Time schedules. So I know the town hall is only open 4 days a week. Do you have inspectors that work Fridays?
We don't. We don't. What we do is before we even put the first shovel in the ground on a construction project, we sit down, we have a pre-construction meeting. We probably say about 25 times, we're closed every Friday. We also tell them, don't wait till the last minute to get your inspections. You know, plan your work and work your plan. We're here till 7 o'clock on Tuesday nights. You know, we're here for the 37 and a half hours. So we find that because we're communicating that, and as I say, with my expediter, she's constantly emailing the contractors. It's not like the old days where they would fill out the paper, put it in the basket, and then, you know, wait. It's all very automated, and because we can use the technology, contractors know that this is what's going on. Is it 150% perfect? Probably not. I'm sure there's the occasional contractor that, you know, didn't get the memo and shows up on a Friday. But
timing. Now, does that ever work to improve the service that way and have them work on a Friday even though the town halls are closed? Schedule.
I think you've gone as far as to in an emergency schedule an inspection on a Friday.
Yeah.
But I don't think we'd want to do it regularly.
because then it would be relied on.
That's the problem. You do it for one, and now you're kind of opening the door.
I think a little about that, you know, because it's a long weekend. You're trying to book all the other contractors.
Yeah. So that's where we are. In a couple other things I just wanted to describe about the department, in 2015, we issued over 1,000 building permits, which is pretty amazing. Year over year, that was almost double from the previous year. And the revenue increase was about 33%. So that's a pretty remarkable statistic. You know, we're also looking at the online permitting. We've gone back and forth on that. We're looking at best practices with some of the other communities. It's not a simple thing because of all the nuances of permitting and fees and all that. So we're continuing to look at it, and that may help us provide even more coverage. But we want to be careful about how we roll that out. In terms of the planning division, we've been focusing very much on how can we do better with economic development. And so we just finished our economic development plan that we've spent the last year and a half working on. Again, how can we sell Reading? How can we bring businesses in? How can we reach out and make Reading the place where people want to locate? That plan has given us a whole laundry list of next steps for implementation. And when the Board of Selectmen heard that, they were very interested in seeing us getting some more staffing in that area. So that's something I'll talk about in a few minutes. Along with the economic development plan, and some of you might remember when we had Professor Bluestone out here from Northeastern University, and he said we did an economic development self-assessment. And it's really looking at yourself in the mirror and saying, what are we doing right, what are we doing wrong in terms of economic development and our attractiveness for business. And one of the big things that comes out of that study was, you know, do an economic development plan, which we did, but also help with the permitting so that there's checklists and guides to make it simpler, because it can be daunting. And so that's what we've been working on. We started it last summer, and then when we had our little staffing turnover, sat on a shelf for a little bit, but we're picking that back up, and it's a How to Do Business in Reading guide, which I think will be a big help. Not only the guide, but the checklist and the flow charts and all of that, just make it simpler. We're also working on zoning. Many of you may remember we did a big thing back in 2014, and zoning is never done, so we continue to plug away at it. Spent a lot of time Monday night at the CPDC talking about the sign bylaw, so there's been a lot of legal action that makes this a big priority that we go and revise that portion of the bylaw. So that was something we had kind of held off on, waiting for this court case to go through, and it recently did. So I won't bore you with the details, but it's a pretty hot issue, and we kind of have to fix that. So that's on the hit list for planning. And I'm sure you're all familiar with the 40B that's been filed with the Zoning Board of Appeals, so that comp permit that that we've spent a lot of time on. So then moving on, you know, historic has been very busy with the hot real estate market with demo delays, and of course the Historic District Commission, that's now a little bit quieted down, but with the summer of activity, we're busy with that. The Historic District Commission met 18 times in 2015, which is probably the most active it's been when it was West Street. And then just moving on, conservation, you know, again, full-time staff has been a great help. Human and Elder Services, you know, they're just always doing stuff down there. Having a full staff has been great. The Veterans Agent regularly meets with a group down there that, you know, just have coffee and integrate veterans with the elder folks, and that's working out really well. We're doing some intergenerational programming with recreation that's been good. And having that nurse advocate there has just been a big help. In public health, we were just talking about, you know, in this world today, all the things we have to think about in public health. So having that fully staffed has been phenomenal. We're looking at going to electronic inspections there to improve efficiency. And another interesting statistic is that we gave out about 1,000 flu shots last year. That's a lot of flu shots. Mm-hmm. Recreation, they are, you know, always busy, over 450 activities in 2015, and just always doing stuff, and we're really lucky to have that group. And then I mentioned about the veterans, you know, being available. So moving on to what's going on in the budget. So I mentioned about the economic development planner. That's an added position, but it is offset by the permits revolving fund. So that position is planned to be funded that way for about 3 years. So that's one thing that you might have noticed in the budget. At the same time that we've added, we've eliminated, so two part-time positions have been eliminated, the planning intern and the health plan reviewer. And that health plan reviewer showed up in expenses as the contract with Melrose. The other thing was the conservation wages. There's a slight increase due to reduction in support, and that's because the revolving fund has seen a decline in the fund balance, so we didn't think it was sustainable. It's a matter of a couple thousand dollars. And then in terms of the overall expenses, the budget shows that they're reduced by about 6.5%. That's mostly because of a one-time expense of $25,000, the hazard mitigation plan that was in FY16. So it's a little bit skewed. And then eliminating that health plan reviewer. And the only other notable thing in expenses is that vets is slightly higher, and that's due to anticipated increase in activity. Recreation, the revolving fund directly pays for all the expenses, so you don't see recreation showing up with any expense money. And then on top of that, the revenue that they generate is typically in line with what the cost is for the wages of that division, so they more or less cover themselves. And one last thing is that the mileage is budgeted slightly higher, and that's to account for the activity inspectors mostly.
Questions.
Sure.
You said permitting for 15 was way up, which is great, but
way
it's something
up.
Percent. How was it looking in the first 2 months of 16?
Busy.
Busy?
Yeah.
Okay. sorry, I got a couple questions.
Can I do a quick follow on?
Sure.
Yeah. Just to that one. So up 33%. Can you tell me dollar wise roughly what that is? I'm sure it's in there and I saw it somewhere.
You mean year over year?
Yes.
I'll whip through a bunch of papers and see if I can answer that. I think I do have that.
And that's fine. If you don't have it.
So in revenue building, it kind of breaks down a couple different ways. In FY14, we collected $420,332 for building fees, $73,980 for wiring fees, and $52,491 for plumbing and gas. Those get grouped together. So that came to about $546,803. And the total for FY15 was $673,576.
Okay.
And we had 892 building permits in 2014, and then adding the wiring and the gas.
Yeah.
And we had over 1,200 building permits in 2015, 1,239. So I can show you the graph.
Is there anything exceptional that happened in that year that would cause that jump that we would anticipate not occurring? Occurring?
You know, there hasn't been that one big project. I mean, Redding Woods has consistently been building for the past 4 or 5 years. So that's been sort of every year. Same thing with Johnson Woods. Johnson Woods has done one major building a year for the past 2 years anyway. There really just hasn't been that one project that I say, oh, well, it's because of this. There's been a lot of additions. There's been a lot of teardowns. And that's why Historic is so busy, because they have to go through the demo delay before they can do the teardown, demolish, and then build something new. And I think there's been just, I think it's the economy. You know, we think that the real estate market goes in 10-year cycles. I don't pretend to be a prognosticator, but that's what we think it is. And we're probably at about year 8.
Okay.
so.
Is Johnson Woods built out of the second?
No, it's phased.
And Redding Woods still have.
Yeah. Redding Woods is ahead of schedule and brisk. The sales are brisk there. And I believe Johnson Woods is, they've put them up and they close. I mean, they're calling us for occupancy permits because they're getting ready to close. So it sounds like everything is a very healthy marketplace for all of that. But Johnson Woods is tricky to understand. We ask for updates regularly. It's tricky because phase one is the units that are closer to West Street, and phase two are the units in the rear that are closer to the Woburn line, and they do a little bit of each. So it's not like you would think they would do all phase one first, you know, being a planner, this is how I think, and then you would go to phase two, but that's not how it is, and I don't know why. I could show you a map and really confuse you. I'm confused.
Jean, overall, are you feeling pretty good about kind of delivering services with your new staff and the structure for 17 at least?
Yeah. You know, I will say the planning intern, we've really gotten a lot of benefit out of having her. She's uniquely great because she's been with us since high school. Mm-hmm. And she was with the town manager's office and then came over to us. She's graduating. So it's going to mean that Julie and I will be doing more grunt work because we don't have a clerk for planning. So we'll be, you know, just roll up your sleeves and do it.
Good. And the new, is it economic development?
Planner, plan. Is what we're calling it, yeah.
That, I assume you'll do planning for that once the budget is approved? Is that the general thing?
I don't like to count my chickens.
<Certainly I'm, irony. laughs>
Let's put it this way. I have everything in the queue. When I get the green light, it'll go.
Okay. And that's, as you said, it's more kind of marketing-oriented development.
Well, that's a good question. I've did a lot of hand-wringing about that because what I think is economic development may not be what the expectation is of the Board of Selectmen, the community. You know, economic development is so broad. We keep hearing from people, and we ask this of developers all the time, what's the one single thing that we should be doing, that we should be a superstar at when it comes to developing property and, you know, being known as a community that is agreeable to economic development? And I always expect them to say, you know, oh, we would really like a tax break, or we would really like to do some sort of, you know, fancy financing around deferring taxes and all of that. And they never say that. They always say, we just want to get our permits. We just want that process to go smooth. So when I keep hearing that time and time again, I think, well, really, you know, kind of what we've been doing with the permitting checklist, the permitting guides, you know, advancing that even more, maybe going with the online permitting, you know, making that part of it so seamless and so easy, we'll be going in the right direction. But I'm not sure. I'm not sure that I think a lot of people that talk about this position think that it should be outbound marketing, you know, sitting down with developers, doing the who's selling Reading piece. So maybe it's a little of both.
Might be great for a public discussion of what that is. That said, I would certainly think that the goal is to bring in some pretty serious C&I, commercial industrial opportunities, the best ones we can find, into the town over the course of the 3 years that person is going to be funded for. I would think that's kind of mission number one, personal opinion.
Yeah. The only trouble with that is we don't have the land. That's a
work with what
minor
we got,
issue.
As they say.
Minor issue. small detail.
There's one already going on, yes.
Yeah, with the economic development plan, we have identified the priority development areas, and they're just small, and they're just not visible. I mean, yeah, we could try and sell someone, and we have. We've driven many developers around and shown them the area behind RMLD, and they look at it and they go, you know, it's not, you can't even access it from Walker's Brook. it's not the greatest location, and it's a small area. You know, Burlington, what they've done with Third Ave and all that, it's like 80 acres, or, you know, to get that level of development, you need a sizable piece of land that is developable. And unfortunately, we just don't have that.
Right. How much can the town influence when it's not our property to try and work closely with the owner of that property? Jointly approved.
Yep, we do. In fact, CPDC made that recommendation for 258 Main Street, the old bridal shop. When they came in preliminarily, they said, well, gee, could you maybe grab one of the other parcels and now combine and, you know, make it a bigger site? Because, again, a small site. These are the one-off redevelopments. It's so tight on South Main Street. And they did. They acquired, or they have an option, I believe they're acquiring the property next door, and now it's a much bigger site, and they can do a much better site plan. It's still tight. We still have concerns about the parking and the access. You know, South Main Street is tough. Traffic backs up. You got to get it right.
And how about where Keurig was? What's it?
Reading Co-op is taking over a vast majority of that, if not all. They're, they moved all of their corporate offices there a year or two ago, and they just keep taking more space.
Just a quick question. You mentioned how this new position was going to pay for itself. Can you remind me of that again?
Yeah.
Three permits of them.
We have a permits revolving fund. Okay. So I think if you look in the budget, you can see the offset in there. When we created the permits revolving fund, it was for the larger projects like Reading Woods, Johnson Woods. And so those funds go into the permit fees. Everything we collect goes in the general fund. So even though we, you know, brought in revenue for 1,000 permits, we never see that money. So in this case, the money for the larger projects is set up into a dedicated fund called the Permits Revolving Fund. That's got
a
sizable balance.
So it's more of a source of funding rather than the position of this person would come in, do things that would pay for itself type of thing. Okay.
Yeah.
With that big commercial industrial development, hopefully.
Well, yeah. Exactly. Technologies.
I got another question just on the new positions and trying to make sure I follow or understand timing of when folks came in and what, if any, positions might still be open. I know, Bob, it's one of the ones we talk about a lot is, you know, somehow or another, we're always regenerating free cash at the end of the year. One of those options tends to be from positions that were still open, yeah. Right? And so I'm just trying to get in my head potential impact that might have on this. So are we now, are there still open positions? Have these positions now been fully open? Because again, to me, it comes back to potentially what will we be regenerating in free cash from this as one potential option?
Yeah, all the positions have been filled. It was a banner year for hiring.
Which is great. I don't mean it to sound like, hey, we're just chasing the money. Obviously, these are important positions that I think are a great addition. I'm happy to hear that the positions are filled.
Yep. Yeah. You know, turnover would be the only thing that you really can never predict.
Yeah.
But hopefully we're in a good place for a while.
Good. Okay.
Questions? All good. Thanks, Gene.
All right. Thank you. Thanks, Gene.
To the library. I saw you looking down here a lot, Amy.
Members of the board coming. There's a seat. There's a chair over here.
Squiggle about it.
Oh, yeah.
I got to keep grabbing it.
Selling tickets.
Whoa. Yeah, maybe all the cars work for this.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah.
You look different today. I see red spinning this one. Was planning to attend but was not able to,
yes.
So she said she'd be very ably represented this evening.
Yes. Our assistant director, I believe, Amy Lannan, and I'm Vicki Yablonsky, Cherry Dubois, David Hutchinson, Andrew Grimes, and Alice Collins on the board.
Great. Do you want to walk us through?
Start. Okay, well, the changes are basic. I mean, other than COLA and STEP increases, which are most of the changes, there is a little bit of money, step in any time if
sure.
I'm not doing this correctly, a little bit of money that was added back into our technology fund because that was cut when we moved into temporary quarters. So now that we're moving back into the new library at the beginning of the next fiscal year, that has been increased back, I believe, back
yep.
to about where it was, 15,000.
Yeah. It's going to be 15.5. If it had been 2.5% and then 2.5%, it would have been 15,300. So it's just a little bit, teeny bit more. The other line that was increased that was cut back was the library supplies and equipment, which is slightly different. That's sort of back of the house stuff. And that was originally a couple years ago, $5,400. It was cut back to $3,000. I'm sorry, it was it's now $7,000. That was increased as well because it was cut for while we were in the temporary space because we wouldn't need as many actual supplies. So those are being restored, and that is partly why, I think if you actually take those out, mm-hmm. it's pretty close to 2.5%.
And we did discontinue about $1,000 for local travel. We had put that in temp quarters because there was a lot of programming going on around town. So we were covering travel for that, but that was taken out of the budget this year.
Cool.
I think the only other question in the funding from the town manager's bottom line is that gives us our 14.7%, I think Ruth sent you that, for our materials expenses, rather than the 15% that we like to keep it at, as we've always had it under the Board of Library Commissioners. We are in a slightly, we've gone into a new population run, slightly over 25,000, but now we're in the 25,000 to 50,000 range, but we're only a couple of hundred over 25,000. So that allows us to go down a little bit, but the board feels that we would really like to keep it, you know, at what it was. That line is about $4,385 less than what it would be for book. It says books there, but it's all materials. It's about $4,385 less than what it would be if we were at our full 15% budget. But other than that, we've taken out everything that was in our, you know, as we were doing our budget planning, everything that was in our original requests, our digital services librarian, which we had wanted for going, you know, I think this was the third year we had it in, and we were hoping to have it as we move back into the new building with a bigger building and more technology, but, you know, we know the budget year is tight. We had a planning process done last year where we had a lot of focus groups and a community survey and meetings with town administrators, library staff, and we do have a 5-year long-range plan. And we are starting, you know, we've started to do a plan, at least for the first 3 years, trying to phase in some of the things that we want to do over the next couple of years. So, for example, you know, there is going to be a lot to learn as we go into the new building this year. So we, one of the things we want to do is reopen Thursday mornings, but we put that off to the second year of the plan, and then the third year, opening a little bit longer on Sundays. And then there are some other staffing positions that we would like to phase in over the next few years, but I think that digital services librarian is our priority.
And you guys are going to be actively in the discussions with the town manager, the Board of Selectmen, in terms of discussions of potential overrides and other activities as it would relate to funds that you might be looking for positions.
I assume that's going to come up.
I think it probably should. Questions, comments?
Yeah, the old library versus the new, does that change the minimum staffing requirements?
I would, to use Jean's lovely term, I would say that's partially why we want to add the position, is because it right-sizes it. It's a bigger building. It's going to be an increase in just people walking in the door. It'll be an increase in materials programs, material circulation and programs. So yeah, I think in order to, you know, much less open, just open Thursdays to actually physically handle that space, it's going to need a little more help.
Right. So do you have feel for what that minimum?
I think it's one, a minimum of one person. Ideally, it would probably be 2.5 over the next 3 years.
Additional FTE, but let's say you're evaluating opening additional hours.
Mm-hmm.
How many people are you talking about?
I'm not sure if it's a people number, but we can tell you that it's about $50,000 to $50,000 for Thursday mornings.
I mean, it wouldn't necessarily be hiring particular new people, but it might be expanding some hours, because we have a lot of part-time people.
Right, so, and it makes a difference too, because right now that's the only time we have for staff meetings. So we push staff meetings to another time when we have to hire substitute librarians, or we have to pay people overtime to come on a Thursday night instead. So there's some other things that go into taking that time away that's kind of integral to the administration of the library. So it's not just, it's 4 hours and it's $100 an hour. So it's a little bit different. There's a lot of administrative work that goes on during that time too that would have to be kind of shifted around.
What's the projected opening day? Is it summer?
Great question, Joe Bob. Excellent question.
Q3.
Excellent. Just a follow-up question on the media library and trying to understand kind of the need and timing. I know it's been brought up a couple years in a row that we really want it. You know, my fear is that we've got a new building with all this technology, and are we going to be phasing this role in too late, right? Do we have technology? First part of the question is, do we have technology that's coming in with the new building that we now can't use, and meaning the general public couldn't use it because the right education isn't there for them to use it, or there are things that, you know, basically are going to be sitting in this new building less than fully utilized that, you know.
I would say it would all be minimally utilized, but I think fully utilized is the problem.
Yeah.
But we understand that, you know, it's very clear that this is just not anywhere in the cards for the library to have a new position.
Yep.
So it's definitely not an A.
Yep.
So we're kind of settling for a little bit less. We're trying to be cooperative. And
I'm sure everyone went through it, but just to ask the hard question, is there something in the existing budget that a non-library person might think of more as that was the past and this is the future we're going to, right? We spent a lot of money on a new building.
No.
Is there traditional services that we could trade one off to the other to say, let's really get the full impact of this? And the answer may be no, but I just want to make sure we've asked the question and we've talked about it, because I think there's high expectations on this building. The latest updates we get sound great. I think we're going to have a phenomenal space. And I just hate every time this one comes up. This is the one that always kind of gets to me, that says, geez, we spent $15-18 million. Are we going to come up this short of, you know, really something that's usable and is going to provide a great benefit?
Let me just give you a kind of a general example. Yeah. So right now we have about four different people or five different people that work on various licensing. So it's be licensing for children's databases, for adult online learning and test preparation, how to get your plumbing license, databases like that, research, magazines, ebooks, downloadable audiobooks. All those require different licensing negotiations. It's spread around, I would say, well, maybe four people. That's something that when it's centralized would be much more efficient, and those people that are doing that work could then be out there teaching more programs, sure, answering more questions. You know, we answer 56,000 questions a year. Do the math on how many that is per minute. Yeah. And add another third, because we expect to have an increase of third in service, people are just going to be waiting in line or not getting their questions answered, yeah, which is fine. If you go to Market Basket and you have to wait in line on Sunday morning, you have to wait in line. However, we would really, really, really like to see the other three registers open up.
But if I could add, it's not only about optimizing the physical technology of the building and the library. It's also about the service offering to the town. So our survey was clear that people are seems infinitely hungry for programs and for all the activities that the library sponsors and houses and runs. That infinite demand would be fed to some extent by the people that are freed up because of the specialists that would do that. But it's also, applying strategy to what else we can do with the library services, you know, in terms of all the digital databases, the training, making sure the staff are current. You know, all the staff get questions on technology, you know, either a laptop question or a database question.
Right.
They need to be up to date. It's hard for this current library staff to keep the library staff state-of-the-art current with the questions that the public has. And again, that this person would be the thought leader on that stuff, as opposed to just making sure that we're using some of the physical assets. So a lot of it's the services that we need to provide. You know, unfortunately, and I think you might ask this before, that the other services just don't go away. Yeah. In fact, it seems like an infinite demand. The circulation continues to go
very, very high.
And then all the other questions. And again, as we've said, the library is an information source as much as a material source.
Sure.
And the information, unfortunately, is delivered by people, mm-hmm, right,
yeah,
that are highly qualified and highly valued. So that this is really a service question,
yeah,
more than an asset optimization, although that's something. You know,
I'd love to see the new position, yeah, but the fact that you can't give up any of these existing, yeah, stuff does speak to the work you guys have been doing, and
right,
obviously doing a great job, and it's there isn't waste there. There isn't, you know, things that people are willing to let go. So that, I mean, that's a testament to you guys, but that's just one on the technology side. I'd love to see that, you know, be able, yeah, to happen given this new building that people are so excited about.
And we struggle like the schools do. I mean,
yeah,
we could give up,
sure,
music, we could give up art, you know, they could give up all of those things and save money.
Yeah.
But, you know, you do make a value commitment to certain things and providing services and providing these programs to the community, to the citizens. So it's a tough call.
Yeah.
Do you ever recruit high school students that need service hours?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. We have a fairly active,
volunteers.
We do. It's been very cut in the temporary space, but we normally have about 50 during the summer. And then we have some active, we usually do a community service program, which, and I don't know if you've ever worked with volunteers, but occasionally working with volunteers takes as much time as the work that they get done, of all ages. But we do have, we do try to take on a few of those community service hours, particularly from the high school, every year in each of the departments. But during the summer, there's a volunteer program specifically for students grades 6 through 12, and we only keep the application process for 14 days because it's very popular.
Yeah, more during the school year, because different organizations, they need service hours.
Absolutely, absolutely. In fact, we'd love to.
Technology support,
yeah,
that's a win.
That's our NECDI program. We have ongoing about 10 students that are trained. They actually receive training on how to teach and work with adults, as well as, you know, how to problem solve and things like that. And then they go on to do one-to-one training, as well as they provide support in our classroom. So if I'm teaching a class on digital photos, I'll have a high schooler there to help me. She'll walk around the other computers, making sure everyone's on the same screen and things like that. So it's excellent, and it's a really great intergenerational program.
I know we asked this last year about the shift from physical books to more digital, and I think the discussion was it was happening slower than one might have imagined. Any update on that?
Seems to me it's leveled off, hasn't it? I mean,
well,
from what
use,
I read in
the use hasn't. I mean, the use has, meaning
right.
in general, in the
right.
population, there are the difference between physical book readers and ebook readers has slowed down. It's not, without getting too agonizingly boring about the licensing process, what I can buy personally for $9.99 for my Kindle is very different from what the library licenses. A lot of it's not available for us to license, and B, licenses cost generally $70 to $80 more than your average Amazon per book. So if I want two copies of James Patterson's online book, it's going to cost me quite a bit more than me buying one copy on my Kindle. So it's not like we can just put down a check and take our entire library and put it into, particularly the fiction. Nonfiction, they don't want any money for. But the fiction books are quite expensive, and not all of the publishers actually will sell to libraries, will lease. Actually, they're not even purchased, they're all leased. So it's a very expensive, slow process. But we work within our consortium, which is Noble, and all the libraries contribute, so we have some buying power and leverage there.
How's that compared to purchasing a hard copy of that same book?
It is more expensive. It receives less circulations, though. Not less circulations, I shouldn't say that, actually. It's just more expensive than a physical book. It's still least expensive for us to buy 12 copies of a hardcover book and see them go out 40 or 50 times than it is to buy, you know, 5 or 6 copies of electronic and they can only go out.
That's so weird.
Well, blame it all on Napster. You know, they figured out a lot of stuff when that came along. So the licensing and leasing of these materials is very, very strict, particularly for, you know, they want to get charged. They would like a fee every time that book goes out, which is not what we want to do.
And people can't donate ebooks, right?
You can't donate an ebook. No, you can contribute to the fund. You can absolutely contribute to the fund, but yes, they're licensed in bulk from a provider. Like our provider happens to be Overdrive.
Right.
So,
do you have any? I'm sorry, one more question on statistics on are more people starting to use Overdrive? And
we definitely. I mean, that continues to be used. Actually, Overdrive is actually also audiobooks. So I would say it's just been a very steady, slow climb. That's also been because our collection has grown. So we started out with a very small collection. It's getting broader, it's getting deeper. We can go get older parts of the series. So we might have started in the middle of the series and now we can go back and get older ones. So the collection itself is really growing. What we cannot track are downloads that people get from the Boston Public Library Overdrive account. Though we have a lot of people who use that account. It's free to every resident, just in case. A little plug here. If you have a library card from any certified library in Massachusetts, you can have an e-card from the Boston Public Library. And they have and they get money from the government to expand their Overdrive library. So we don't know how many people. I can tell you personally, I check out as many from the Boston Public Library as I do from the Reading Public Library. So.
Because I remember they all seem to have waiting lists. I think
they absolutely do. Absolutely.
You get the e-readers,
absolutely.
You go, fine, I'll pay my time.
We have a lot of people who will put their name both on the digital book and the print book, and then whichever one comes in first. So it's definitely but it's for many, many people, it's a viable alternative to going to Barnes & Noble because not everybody can do that. It's still important. We also have, I don't know if you know this too, we have downloadable music that's not leased. You actually can download and own the music. And we also have downloadable magazines. Again, you can put them on your iPad and take them and read them. And once you own them, once you've downloaded them, they stay on your device, or you can download them for as long as you want. So we do have a fairly significant actual digital, beyond that database term, which nobody knows what that is, but we do have a significant collection of digital download materials.
So if I'm understanding this correctly, even though the demand for hard copy circulation has perhaps decreased slightly, or has it, it's maintained level?
I would say it's maintained level because, yeah, the wait lists on the books are still quite low.
So that's maintained level, and now the digital content is increasing in demand.
Yes.
And that's actually more expensive.
Yes. Yes. Okay. It doesn't make any sense, but...
So there's no ability to cost it, essentially, is what's happening.
No.
And in fact,
no.
It almost sounds like as demand for digital services increases, that's going to increase.
People just realize how easy it is to get the stuff. When I first started working at the Reading Public Library, I believe that Dan Brown's Da Vinci Code was out, and it was unheard of. There were 175 holds on that book. That was unheard of. So this was like 10 years ago. When the minute a James Patterson book comes out, there are regularly 500-600 people on that wait list. But now, there's a lot of copies of that. But people take advantage of that service a lot. So.
Other questions?
One more just quick question. The 15% spending limit, I think you mentioned we're now falling below it, but that's okay. We're at a lower, and I just missed, why are we at a lower
because
threshold?
Because Reading has moved into this larger population.
Population, okay, yep.
The Board of Library Commissioners has put us into a group that now says you only actually have to spend 13% of your budget on materials. But we're just over the 25,000.
Sure.
So if you're a city, probably 50,000, your budget is going to be much bigger, so having 13% of that budget gives you a lot of buying power. But going from 15 down below that for us, when our population is virtually the same, it puts a dent into our buying budget. So we're hoping, at least for a while, to stay at that 15%, because that's our basic services is providing materials.
Yeah,
and we're actually it's about 14.7.
We're at 14.7.
Yeah, it's about three or $4,000 below.
So it's 15. Just over 4,000 below.
Any other questions, comments? Good. Thank you guys very much.
Thank you.
Yeah. I was going to be parking. Thanks, guys.
Good evening.
Good evening.
How are you?
You ready? Yeah. Oh, let's look over here. Joe's all set. Yeah.
I guess we don't need Bob, right? We can just stop.
Yeah, he'll be back. He probably knows most of what you're going to say.
I probably better than I do. Just a couple things before I start. I'd just like to recognize my assistant director, Jane Kinsella, assistant public works director since September, I guess, but had been a business manager for a number of years prior to that and moved up to town manager's office for a while as a business administrator, as now as assistant director. So we asked her to have her back and doing a lot of things for public works as well as maybe a few things for some other departments, but she's doing a great job. I just want to recognize her.
And this is Jeff Zager, who's a great asset to
What I thought I'd do was kind of summarize some of the changes in the FY17 budget as compared to 16 and kind of summarize some of those, and then maybe talk about some of the issues that have happened in the department over the last couple of years that I think the committee might be interested in. Overall, the budget is up 2.1% from last year. And actually, if you factor in the other accounts, the other major accounts that I have, the non-accommodated costs for the trash and street lighting and snow, it's really up 0.6%. So it's pretty much level funded in general. As you know, the public works is made up of the highway equipment maintenance division, the parks and forestry cemetery, which is one division between the three operations, water, sewer, engineering, and administration. Currently, we have 55 FTEs in the department, which is down one from FY16. There's one engineer's position that we'll talk a little bit more maybe when you get to the enterprise for stormwater, but that's where that position was, but it's one less full-time position. Actually, we're down one. We have five long-term seasonal positions, down one. I called one intern that we're losing in engineering, kind of a long-term seasonal type position, so that's one additional reduction from 16 going to 17. And we maintain four short-term seasonal positions in the budget, which is the same as 16. In general, wages are up 2.9%. As I mentioned, part of the overall effect is the elimination of that intern in engineering, 16.4% reduction in that position. We did add $4,000 to the overtime in the engineering department. We've got some changes coming up, some reorganization coming up in engineering. I think for coverage, it makes sense to put some additional funding in there. Also, it helps us out on the off days, where, as you know, the engineering works the 10-hour days, but at least Friday, well, we still have paving on Friday, we still have things going on, so occasionally get a staff person out there to cover, make sure the town is represented in those activities, so that'll help out in that area. And again, also in engineering, you'll notice the town engineer is being bumped up. I think Bob mentioned this in his presentation, from 37.5 to 40 hours a week, and that'll be in line with all the supervisors in the rest of the department, which makes sense.
Excuse me, Jeff, what the savings from the intern, what kind of dollars?
$16,000. Under administration, similarly, my position is going to go from 37.5 to 40 hours a week. And again, that'll across the board, that'll make all those supervisory positions, public works, 40 hours, which I think makes sense. Under administration, the wages does reflect the two reclassifications we did this year. We had a couple of people move up. A secretary position got upgraded, and an administrative assistant to a senior administrative assistant position was upgraded based on this classification study and based on the results of that. So that's incorporated in the FY17 budget.
When you say the classification,
yes.
Paying class.
Yes, paying class. So in general, all divisions reflect in the wages, the collective bargaining agreements we have. We have three unions in the public works. We have the ASME union, the engineering has a separate union, and now we have a supervisory union for the public works supervisors. So we have three, and reflecting those collective bargaining agreements are incorporated in the FY17 wages. Also, we have a few non-union people that, again, in their wages section, it reflects the COLA of 3% and a step rate, if applicable, if they're in a position to get that, which would be the same as the union contracts. Looking at expenses, the in general, it's basically level funded. Actually, it's down 0.3% overall in the budget. There are a couple of small pluses and minuses. I have a small increase in my professional development account. Again, with some of the changes and some of the staffing, especially engineering, I thought it was important to have some additional funding in there for training and for education for some potential new employees coming in. Also, there's in expenses in engineering, there's a small increase in the traffic control repairs account that is reflective of an attempt to set up a kind of a preventive maintenance program for the signal lights now, where some of them are getting pretty old, and on occasion we have some issues with them. So I think this set up a kind of a preventive maintenance program with those to kind of head off any potential problems down the road makes sense. So it's a small increase in that line item for expenses. In the highway, there's a couple of small increases as well in the equipment and vehicle parts repair, the outsourcing line item, basically reflecting a couple of things. One is, I think, just an increase in overall cost of parts over the last couple of years. But also, there's some of the equipment, not to pick on Greg, but some of the specialized equipment, because a little older, some of those repairs get more expensive, and a lot of times they have to be farmed out because of just the specialized nature of the equipment and so forth. So that kind of is driving that up a little bit from FY16. Also, I have a small increase in the highway expenses under the police details, reflective of an increase of police detail costs going in forward in FY17, as well as some additional projects we'll be looking at. And some of the accommodated costs, the big items I mentioned, specifically the snow and ice is level funded. going to FY17. I know when I came 7 years ago, we kind of started a program. We were kind of bumping that up every year to try to get closer to the 10-year average. I think we started, when I started, I think it was around 500,000, maybe 525, and we're up to 625. So last couple of years, we kind of got away from that. But the average is now, I think you see in the report, is 850,000. That's a 10-year average. Although last year's kind of skewed that average a little bit. I'm hoping this year will maybe skew it the other way. So far, so good. But so that's pretty much level funded based on
So you
got to
ask, what are we at this year?
Yeah.
Balance?
What's it?
So we are, right now we have a balance. We have a balance of 150,000 in that account, out of 625, roughly, depending on what Bob ends up doing at town meeting. And the thing is, it's interesting that the people are a little surprised where, I mean, we've had like 15 calls for our guys to go out just salting and sanding. You know, you get a half an inch, you've got to go out. So, and then we've had I believe six actual plowing operations. You wouldn't think so, but we've had six, and out of the six, we've had two with contractors. So a lot of times, if we have, you know, 1 or 2 weeks, we can do it ourselves. The guys can do it. It takes longer, but you save some money. But actually, I had had someone come in this year to look at our overall snow removal and plowing operation. And we tweaked it a little bit, but one of the things we looked at is, in the past, when you'd get 1, 2, 3 inches of snow, you'd really work on the chemicals. You'd really use a lot of salt and sand to try to knock that down an inch at a time and so forth, as opposed to calling in the contractors. Well, that was okay maybe when salt was, you know, 25, 30 bucks a ton. Well, now it's like 65 bucks a ton. So the more material you use, you know, it gets expensive, plus you're putting a lot of material down, which I don't necessarily like to do if I don't have to. So what we've done a couple times this year is, you know, we would go and do some pre-treating where, you know, the storm's coming in, and then let have a couple of inches accumulate, and then bring the contractors in for a short period of time, have them basically scrape everything down, and then hitting it at the end with some material. So, and believe it or not, actually that's less expensive than just constantly pouring that material out at that cost. So a little different dynamic, a little change of kind of a philosophy, but I think because this year's been a little strange with, you know, the rain, then the snow, then the ice, and back to snow again. And we had a couple instances where, you know, I'd have the guys in, and they'd be there for, when you get the first couple of inches, well, they need to have a delay. Well, you can't really send them home because, you know, you got more snow coming. I mean, one storm we had 6 inches of snow, 5 to 6 inches, but it was over 12 hours. So it makes it kind of difficult to deal with it, but it's the only way you can really to keep them online and working as you go along. So, but that's worked out pretty well. The accommodated costs, the street lining is a slight decrease going in for next year. That's something we got from RMLD that incorporated the budget, which is nice. And the trash recycling contract is out now. We're looking at analyzing our options now. We've got a couple of proposals in. There's definitely going to be an increase in FY17 in that account, and it basically is all driven by the recycling market and commodities. Right now, believe it or not, in talking with some of the contractors, they're actually, I know one of them in particular is actually paying $40 a ton to get rid of recycled materials, as opposed to a year ago, they were getting paid for that material. It's just the market is such that commodities are such as they change dramatically, and that's kind of driving that equation. So we're working on it. Again, recycling-wise, we're still doing phenomenal. I mean, December, we had 35% recycling, which is the highest ever we've had in the town. We're averaging like 30% a month, which is, again, extraordinary. I think you saw that in the write-up. And is it 2012, we got a municipal recycle of the year. So we're doing a lot of good things, and things are happening there. It's just that market is kind of, and that could change, you know, a year from now. But for right now, we're just kind of, that's where we are. But
so is that contract you're looking at, would that be a yearly contract?
No, it'll be multiple years. It could be a 5-year, it could be a 10-year, depending on what we negotiate. Again, solid waste removal and recycling is one of the things you basically negotiate. And we went out for some proposals for some companies, but it's basically something you negotiate. Really, you don't even have to go out there. But if you remember, they actually came in almost a year ago with a 10-year proposal. And at the time, well, first of all, at the time, we had to go to town meeting to be able to vote to get it over 3 years. The town meeting did that. So now we're in a position we could do a 5 or 10-year, depending on, you know, how it all turns out. But we're working really hard on that contract, and we'll get that squared away.
When you put a contract like that out, are you saying, course, weekly pickup. Are you saying that, oh, we restrict the number of barrels by X or?
We have a program where, based on, as you remember, the last contract, which was 5 years ago, we made a lot of changes. Mm-hmm. I mean, we restrict the number of containers, barrels that people could put out. Recycling became mandatory, where it had been on the books for a number of years, but it never was enforced.
They wouldn't pick up your trash to the recycling.
Exactly. I mean, it was there, and I remember going to Selectman and Town Manager's office saying, you know, this is here, and we start doing this, which I recommend we do, we're going to get the call. So, but and I have to say, the Selectman supported me 100%, the Town Manager, Peter Time, and with Boy Bob. So it worked out well, I think they're up to like 7 or 8 communities now that have incorporated the exact same program we have, the mandatory recycling, the 6 leaf collections a year, the 2 big recycling days that we do at the garage for rigid plastics and shredding and all that. So really, we've done a lot, and well, like I said, we got into water, the town got into water for that in that area. So really, we've done a lot. But those things actually were put in place the last contract, which worked out real well.
Chip, how's our overall tonnage if you put together the waste plus recycling? Is that moving up, down?
It's pretty steady. I mean, overall, I mean, the total, the trash and the recycling, again, now with the mandatory recycling in place, I mean, we're averaging like a 30% per month total, pretty steady. I'm not sure what our total tonnage, I think we're like
7,000
tons. So, once we put that restriction on from unlimited to 4 barrels, that helped a lot.
Yeah.
You know, and actually we did an audit a year and a half ago, and it was kind of seat of the pants, but we got some decent information, and we found that, I talk about potentially reducing from 4 barrels maybe to 3 or 2, but we found that I think we came up with like 90, almost 98% of the people are already doing 3 or less. 92%, 3% are already doing 2 or less. So to go from 4 to 2, you're really not going to, if you're already doing that based on the mandatory recycling component, so really, unless you did something really drastic like went to 1 barrel with overflow bags, I mean, there's things you could maybe do, but I know we talked about that with Bob and the board, and I think the program works really well now, and people are really, I think, really still really happy with it.
Oh, and contract-wise, you end up paying per ton or per
right,
pound.
Right, for disposal.
So, I get it.
Yep,
right.
Yep.
Except
so
for the recycling,
like contract.
Right, whatever you're recycling comes out of the tipping fee.
But in the new contract, potentially, it would be...
Well, I think we have a tipping fee set with Covantage, a separate contract. We have a 5-year contract, and that's... 62 something a ton, which is a really good price for the tipping fee. What we're out for now is the pickup, the rubbish and recycling pickup. So the disposal, so basically JRM is the contractor now. They take it to Covanta for the disposal. So that's a separate contract, and I think this is the second year of a 5-year contract for our disposal. We also I have a consortium. I get together with Stoneham and Wakefield. We sit down and we do that as a consortium, and Covanta is giving us a pretty good deal right now. Out of the 13 or 14 communities around us, we're like the second lowest tipping fee, which is pretty good. I think Haverhill is low. Well, Covanta's in Haverhill, so that's probably why. But in general, we do pretty well in that fee. A couple of things I think that the community might be interested in, just some updates. Talk a little about staffing and some of the changes. Since 2010, I know some of this information actually is in the budget as well, but since 2010, we've had 12 retirements, 22 promotions, 16 new hires, replaced 3 supervisory staff positions, and actually we've got one more will be coming up. As you maybe, I think you might be aware, the town engineer is retiring. Actually, I'm advertising that position right now. There'll be another one, and then there's a strong potential that my 5th supervisor will also be retiring in a year from now. So in the course of that time, a lot of changes, and we've been fortunate. We've had some people. We've got a very strong professional development training program, Bob has been very good about funding that. Actually, a little bit of an increased issue in the budget to get people with the proper licenses, the proper training, and the proper background to be able to move up internally. And I tell people the best story is my highway supervisor, Mike Debrigada, retired after 46 years here. The bad news is he retired 46 years. The good news is I promoted George Fazeri, who was here 40 years. So I lost 6 years in the translation, but it's not too bad in terms of experience and background. So they worked out pretty well. But I guess the point is a lot of changes since I've been there in my 7 years. The assistant director position, that's a new position that we established. And again, I mentioned the engineer. Now we're looking at, we're advertising right now. And I have requested a transfer at town meeting to have like an overlap period to put some money in there. My goal is to get somebody on board right around town meeting, hopefully, to be able to have, the current engineer is retiring in June, and towards the end of June. So I want to have that 6-8 week overlap, I think is important with all the projects we got going on. And depending on what happened, you know, we may have, I'm assuming we have an internal candidate, external, whatever, we'll just see what happens, you know. And that'd be my target to get that done. The road program that we've had over the last number of years, since 2011, roads, 107 roads, sections of roads, have been resurfaced, 22.5 miles, a total cost of $6.1 million. So we've done a lot. I mean, a lot of roads. When we started the program, our PCI, which is our pavement condition index, was 72. And actually, this coming spring or summer, scheduling-wise, I'm about to have a field investigation done where actually a couple people would go out from an engineering firm and actually ride all the streets and check on the condition of the roads. And I'm anticipating that pavement condition index really going up. It's high because you think it'd go up really dramatically. Well, it's not going to go up dramatically, but it's, the question is going to go up. I'm hoping even the high 70s, which is very good. I mean, it's not top, but it's very, very good. Where, you know, 100 being, you know, brand new streets, every street to town. So you get to 79, 80%, that's pretty good. And that's kudos to the town to continue to fund that, not only with the Chapter 90 money, but with town money. I mean, I tell people that, you know, I get over $1 million for roads, and when the town comes in with $400,000 or $500,000, they get very jealous, and, you know, because a lot of communities, all they have is the Chapter 9 money. It's due to do the budget constraints and so forth. So we've done really well in that area. The other thing I want to mention, and I know that the committee is probably aware of that, our new customer service program, C-Click-Fix, that's been up and running for a while now. We've had 557 requests, and the good part about it, it enables the supervisors and foremen and SO personnel to receive and respond to these requests in the field as they come in. And we put some in, and then people send in pictures, and we've done a lot. In fact, I think some of the categories, we've had 92 potholes issued and fixed. These were all fixed. I'll leave the fixed word fixed out, but potholes were 92. We had sidewalk issues 57, trees and branches 37, streetlights 31, snow and ice 28, signs 24, rubbish recycling 13, water issues 10, tree removal requests 4. So it runs the gamut of a lot of different areas. When the program was rolled out, it was specifically, I mean, Public Works was obviously the main component. I know the town manager's office is obviously involved with this particular program as well. In fact, we just re-upped our license, I guess, for another year. And I think the plan is to kind of expand this town-wide more so than it is now. So there are potential additional offshoots, I think, down the road. Once the whole town is involved and looking to this potentially as a way to kind of get into a more of a formal work order system for the department. I mean, it kind of would be the logical next step to do that. And I know Joe with facilities, they've got a work order system over there, school do, need like, I've talked a little bit about some type of a similar type program for public work. So again, that may be a goal of mine, maybe next year as we go through the process. So that's good stuff.
I wonder if you could get people at town meeting to download the app.
Yeah.
Or on their phone.
On their phones. Yeah. I mean, I hadn't even heard of it until the selectmen's meeting.
Really?
I downloaded it, but
it's actually cute little experience. Yeah. Because often
it's right on the website.
You notice these things when you are out, and that's when you want your phone. I mean, that's when, because sometimes these apps, I'm like, I don't want to do it.
It's very easy. I really.
But something like that, you tend to be doing it when you're out and about, not your computer.
Yeah, no, it's working out really well. People are very happy with it. And finally, I'd just like to kind of summarize some of the, we've got a big year coming out, FY17, a lot of things going on, a lot of capital things going on. Just quickly, I mean, obviously West Street is continuing on. Oh, that's not our project, it's a DOT project, but that'll continue, it'll pick up in the spring. Actually, we're really fortunate. We're out there working along just because of the winter we had, doing a lot of conduit work, a lot of curbing work to kind of continue on, and as opposed to kind of dropping it off, picking it up in the spring. But we'll hopefully get that project done by July, June, July. That's the plan, and right now it looks pretty good. Oak Street, that's the NWRA water project. That's going to be starting up in the spring. Actually, it's kind of starting up now, doing some preliminary work. But that'll be, and they're hoping to get that completed by the fall. Salem Street, that's a town water main replacement project. That's going to be starting up in the spring. Again, hopefully getting that done by the fall. We've got a Grove Street water project. That's actually, it's in your capital budget. That's going to be starting up again in the spring. We got a sewer station rehab, the two sewer stations, Bachelor and West. Those have been awarded. We've met with a contractor. They'll be starting up work probably sometime in the spring or summer. Again, hopefully completed by this year.
Sorry, what's a Grove Street water
sewer project? Sewer rehab. We've got 12 sewer stations, and actually they're kind of laid out in the capital over a period of like I think 10 years.
It's longer now.
So yeah, it's longer now, but
that's replacing some of the.
The sewer stations are really just old. I mean,
I
you go down there and look at, you don't want to go down and look at some of them. Especially I don't think there's anything planned for 17, but 18, we've got a couple big ones. For example, the Child Street, at the intersection of Child, is a sewer station. That could be like $1 million project, that one project. I mean, if you ever go down there, it's like there's a ladder going down. It's pretty bizarre. So I think to get those lined up over a course of X amount of years really is a plus for the town to look at that as an infrastructure improvement that needs to be done.
And then owners are responsible for them and the pipe there to their house.
Right. So we had our road program coming up for FY, it was starting the spring, FY 16 and 17. We have that lined up. The contract will be coming in. We've got 15 streets to do. Again, starting up in the spring, and that'll run through the summer and the fall. We've got a number of in-house drainage projects, Bond Street, Grove Street, Main Street Culvert, a lot of projects going on in-house. We've got some of our own paving to do. If you recall, the town a number of years ago, 3 years ago, I think, bought a new a paving machine, which now allows us to do some work, which saves some money. For example, I have a contractor come in maybe and mill a street. What's a good example? Lodge Lane, we put a water service in there. Not a long street, but right now it needs to be reclaimed. So I'll have the contractor reclaim it, and I'll have our guys go in and pave it with the paver. It's pretty straightforward, not too many structures, but it really saves money on the other end as opposed to having the contractor do it. So, and we're in a position where we can pave probably half a dozen streets a year with our guys in-house, which is a real plus.
And you get a special pothole machine that was more
effective. We do. We have a hot box that we use now, and it's worked out really well. And we go out for the day. It holds like 2 tons of mix, which is like two guys' day's work. If you notice them around, they did a bunch of stuff on Salem Street. They're around everywhere. Actually, we're in a decent position now. We're caught up. And yeah, we approved that, I think, maybe 3 years ago, 3 or 4 years ago. Initially, part of the rationale was we could potentially, you could use material, like, and save your material. Like, if you had some berm work, some cribbing work, you could save that material, stockpile it, and actually put it into the machine, and put the machine set to come on like at 3 a.m. or something, and heat the material up. And we do some of that, although it's hard to do that to really get the mixture that you need and the consistency that you need. So most of the time we'll go up to the plants and just come back with 2 or 3 tons of mix. But that capability is there. But above and beyond, it keeps the material hot. And we've totally gotten away from, I don't know if you remember the old days, we had coal patch, which was was just a waste. I mean, the material you throw it, it'd last a day, and between the rain and the material, it would just come out. So we do permanent patches now, which really obviously lasts long, and it's a big advantage. So that's kind of stuff that's happening and so forth. It's an active, reactive department, and we've had a lot of changes in staff and coming up. the town engineer. That's a big job. I mean, there's a lot of things going on here. We do a lot. We have a very aggressive capital program, and I'm looking to get that position structured properly with the right type of background. I mean, between the technical expertise and then also the management type of project management expertise that I'm looking for. So that's what I'm looking for, and hopefully that's what we'll get going forward and go from there.
How do you feel about the number of projects you've got, the staffing you have?
I think just to be seen. I'm a little concerned, to be honest with you. I mean, I think we've gone, if you go back, actually, I think 3 or 4 years ago, we had 7 people in that department. We had 2 actually surveyors, one that retired, a slot that we didn't fill, Donnie Waters. And obviously, we're losing an intern, and also we're losing an engineer this year, so we've gone down to 4 people. But I think overall, with looking at, and Bob and I have talked about this, we've looked at the capital program a couple of the out years, maybe not being quite as aggressive, which is okay. I mean, based on your overall funding situation and bonding and so forth, you might want to, you know, kind of look at that as a potential way to kind of even things out a little bit. But I think there's definitely the talent is there, and if it's a situation where we may have to look on the outside to bring some outside expertise in, I'll do that. So I'm confident we can make it work, and I think we've got some good people there to make it work.
Any other variable costs for the summer, like gasoline, or are there any expenses that are variable in this budget?
No, I think we've got a lot of the stuff in the budget is we've got a lot of contracts, you know, fixed prices and so forth. The fuel cost is. As anybody's guess, I mean, right now we're in a position where, you know, it's, I think, what was our last fuel bill?
It was like there's no snow, so I don't want
to talk about it, but it was in the dollar, some low dollar somethings, you know, because actually we are in a consortium for fuel, and we go out to bid for that, so, and fortunately we've been able to do a few things with that, and again, I don't want to talk about stuff like that, but in general, no, we're in pretty good shape. All the contracts are fixed personal services, and all our materials are up by contract, 90% of them, so I'm pretty confident we're in good shape there.
Good. And if fuel prices stay low, then you might have a little more buffer.
Might have extra.
Yeah, if you go November, maybe
April,
like,
so you
yeah.
May
yeah. And again, I'll be honest with you, like I say, I mean, they may be by a little potential solid waste or buffer. We'll see.
Yeah.
We'll see.
Right, we must also see that public safety too. Those savings, right? They must go through a fair.
All the fuel, yeah. All the fuel.
All the fuel.
It all
goes through.
Yeah.
Oh, I got it.
And actually, we also fuel RMLD. We set up a bill. I mean, but they take advantage of the pricing, which otherwise they'd have to be on their own. So, and again, but also they're helping out with some of the other costs. For example, some of the work we're doing at the fuel pumps, they'll pitch it because I mean they're participating in those savings and they're
part. That usage, I assume, drives some of your volume anyway.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Does the school department get fuel through as well?
Yeah. Yep.
You're like the chic.
School department should be too much, right?
Are they?
No, so facilities.
Facilities now, right.
Oh,
now,
okay.
It used to be, yeah, facilities basically.
Should we buy barrels now? The barrels are the expensive part, right?
No,
the contents are cheap. Any other questions?
Comments?
No, it's good.
Thank you.
Enterprise.
I'll spend a couple of minutes on the enterprise funds, and I'll do it for our financial statement. Jeff's talked about some of the projects, which are written up on pages 120 and 121. Just to begin, the reserves, much like free cash, actually much more so, they're very healthy, to say the least. The target is $2.5 million. We have almost $7 million. It's kind of an absurdity of riches. Unlike free cash, where there's somewhat random regeneration, we know exactly what's going on here. And the biggest driver by far is capital projects not done. And that's because the capital projects were more expensive when we went out to bid. So some of the sewer stations, for instance, we did have a 10-year program, and we're already into about the second year. And we went out for the bid on the first ones. I think the prices were 60% higher than we had anticipated through an expert. Not in that town. And so we pushed it out to, I think it's 18 or 20 years now. But that's so some of the money in the past that has been charged residents has not been used. So it's coming back. Effectively, you have that $4 million, $4.5 million of surplus. I'll exclude stormwater. I do want to spend a little time talking about that. It's quite different. But if you see over here in the upper right-hand column, there's some pretty healthy planned use of reserves. Next year, $800,000 in water, you know, and so on and so forth. So that at the end of just a four-year period, the surplus reserves in water and sewer would be much lower. And even with that use of reserves, we're still looking at budgets running 5 to 6% a year. So infrastructure is not, you know, getting any cheaper to do. But philosophically, both from a what can we afford and what should the ratepayers have to pay for, as well as how are we staffed and can we really do this much capital, we definitely plan to slow down, both in water and in sewer. No question about that. It's not ideal, but part of it's a manpower and part of it is, again, a rate issue. And frankly, even at a slower pace, we're still doing better than probably 95% of the other communities that don't do as good a job with their infrastructure.
Right, so some of that reserve is used for the projects and some is used for adjusting.
It's just kind of thrown into the whole budget as an offset, so it's hard to know how you'd classify it.
Yeah. But
I tend to look at things that vary, like the MWRA charge in sewer is a big one.
Yeah.
You know, if they go up 3%, it's a certain impact. They go up 6%, it's huge because it's 3/4 of the budget. So that's what the sewer offset generally is in my mind, and then projects, capital projects, yeah.
Yeah, so is it hard to come up with then what the money is that you're going to use then? Because depending on the MWRA rates, to understand how much you have to act that, as that buffer for the rate?
You know, they give us a forecast. It took me several years to finally realize it's always 1% lower than what they say. Yeah, it took me a while.
Expectations everything.
Yeah, exactly. Like, oh, only 8. Great.
Yeah. We played that game with healthcare.
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly right. But, you know, their future costs look like they should be higher than their past costs, is the fairest way I can say it. Mm-hmm. They've done a really nice job. They've, just like we have, they're running out of tools. They've refinanced all their debt. They've played all the financial tricks they can. They just have raw capital costs now, just like we do. So it would seem that the days of us, you can see down here, it's a little hard to read, you know, our average increases over this long period of time were below 5% for water and sewer. And this is an anomaly because we eliminated the discount, so it doesn't really count.
Not real.
But there's really only a couple of periods where this was high. This was during the treatment plant closing, and we had some upfront costs. And then this was a big volume adjustment because we had so much conservation going on, we weren't selling enough water. And now we don't have to do that for next year. But in general, our infrastructure is getting expensive. And I'm actually going to come back to this later tonight when we talk about since the last override, what's going on. Here's the assumption on volume. You can see on the left. So there was that big adjustment when we had to drop that volume adjustment. That was a big increase. I think that had changed the prices up almost 10%. Here's some of the capital projects that Jeff talked about. We are going to need to debt finance probably the rest of the sewer projects because we just can't afford a one-year outlay of what they're going to cost now that we know they're much more expensive. So we're trying to group them together to be a little more effective and get two of them done, for instance. So there's, he mentioned Charles and Sturgis is the next group in a couple of years. I want to spend a little more time on two more things. One's the overhead calculation, and the other is the stormwater fund. And they are overlapped to a degree. The overhead calculation is, as you can see, Sharon looked at the method we were using, and Jane looked as well. And they came up with a whole new formula, a much simpler one, for doing an overhead calculation. And, you know, in the world of finance, this is a paintbrush. This is all art. There's no science here. There's many, many different ways to do it. Some of them are very bad. The rest of them are okay. We're using an okay one. You know, at the extreme, you could cost account everything you do, and it would cost you a lot of money to do that, to figure that out. We don't have the staff or the time to cost account how much, you know, actual time is used on the overhead for enterprise funds. So it's now an FTE-based system. You can see the net impact
was right here, the FY16 old to new calculation. This is what we actually used in the budget for town meeting. And the change they made is essentially no change net total. But in, within those, big change. Water is going to be hit with much more of an overhead charge and sewer less, and that reflects the FTEs in those divisions. If you recall, I said that sewer, the budget's about three quarters the MWRA expense. There's not a lot of FTEs we have in that division. So the overhead is now going to reflect that. And the overhead, just so you're clear, is a combination of several things. Some of it's town hall, some of it's my salary, some of it's up in the finance department. But then the bulk of it is DPW. It's administration, Jeff's salary, engineering salaries, some highway expenses. So there's lots of spreadsheets that go into this. It's not just a real simple number, but the concept is a little easier. And you can see that, again, net, not much of a change over 1 year. And then here's the change for FY17. You have a question?
Yeah, what's the big advantage? Am I missing it?
We weren't sure if we got audited, whether we could defend the old way.
Okay. Yeah. That's all right.
That's the simplest answer.
That makes sense. Okay.
Yeah, now it's real simple. Stormwater, same calculation went through, same philosophy. In the past, the stormwater did not have an overhead charge assigned to it. The thinking was it really needs to. It's the same as the other two enterprise funds. So you can see down here, the old method, if you will, had zero for the overhead, but it had a $59,700 employee, the engineering position that we eliminated, which also had benefits associated, and that's an estimate, that's not a real number. So if you will, we took away, well, we had about $78,000 of expense in this fund. This position is no longer in the fund, and I'll come back to that. We've effectively increased by $8,000 or $9,000 what it used to pay versus it going to pay. So there is a difference. It's not like water and sewer where there's no change at all. This is a little bit of an increase. The new method allocates wages and benefits of all the engineering staff. Because in point of fact, this one position was not devoting 100% of its time to stormwater, and the other engineers were not doing zero. It was a convenience. We put one salary in there, and it was approximately one FTE of work is going on in there in this method. So it's much cleaner to do it this new accounting way. And the reason it was important to set this up now is because the stormwater fund in the future is going to be a real interesting political discussion with the selectmen. There's new federal regulations that are due this month or next. And even at the town manager level now, we're talking about it, so you know it's kind of a big deal. People are worried about needing to go, like a community of the size of Reading, let's pretend we are doing nothing, suddenly having $1 to $2 million a year needed for stormwater. So just think about that.
That's crazy.
Well, that's the regulations coming down. And, you know, we've been grandfathered for a certain amount of time, given our size. They started with some of the cities and some of the bigger ones. But there is a cost.
Work that would,
well, there's a cost coming, and the philosophical discussion will be general fund or stormwater fund. What I've put in here for discussion, and the selectmen are going to have a rate setting hearing at the end of March. It's not controversial for next year, but it could be after that. It's a little hard to read, but we're going to be able to hit the $40 fee for the single family home next year. I'm suggesting it probably goes to $100 the year after that in order to deal with some of these regulations. And we have capital work that we need to do that has historically not been done inside the tax levy. It's just not been done. So the question will be, where do we do it? Do we do it inside the tax levy or do we do it in this fund? We've had money put in as generic drainage work for years. And you don't necessarily know the street or the name, and the work gets done. Some of the future drainage projects are larger, and they have actual street names. And you can't suddenly just spend $100,000 on the whole town, and you're fine, because one project could be $125,000, and you still need to do generic work. So in the capital plan, you'll see listed a variety of projects that are critical to do, because basically people's homes are being flooded. And again, for next year, we're fine. We have those high reserves. We can do it for a year. We can maybe do it for 2 years. But philosophically, the selectmen will have to wrestle with this over the next 12 to 18 months of what to do next, just to make that clear.
Could you
explain a little bit of what the goal is there and what these regulations,
from a federal standpoint?
Yeah, and just explain to us what projects you end up
with. The town manager will say to overly regulate you.
We're waiting for this new municipal permit to come through for like 3 or 4 years. Originally, that's why I think this position was put in there, is you need to kind of oversee this project, so forth. Well, it's been delayed, and finally, and we've done a lot of these things already in-house. And it's fortunate because we have the enterprise fund. You imagine if all these regulations are coming down, and if you're going to come up with these funds, and you don't have any funding source. A lot of my colleagues, I mean, maybe they got to go to their highway budget or some other budget to start funding some of these mandated items. So we've done some of the work. For example, we've identified a lot of our outfalls out in the field. But the next step is
sorry, what's
the culverts and the overflows of streams, rivers that are flowing into like bodies of water, creeks or ponds. Well, now there's a testing requirement coming up where you've got this creek that dumps into a culvert, into like a pond. You've got to do some sampling, wet weather sampling, dry weather sampling. There's a whole set of rules and regulations that are going to cost, involve the staff, and they're going to cost funds to do the testing. And there's a whole series of things that seriously, probably
for the goal of finding
emergency management.
It's part of the Clean Water Act, Clean Water Act that was passed a number of years ago, and this is all part of the requirements that have been coming down over the last 10-15 years to clean up all the source of pollutants, flowing into any water bodies. It's all part of the Clean Water Act, and I would say over the last.
So is that the big goal?
That's the ultimate goal. We're fortunate we have a funding source that was voted on before my time, Savage Enterprise Fund, and went through the challenges of a fee and a tax, and went through that whole scenario. And I would probably, every couple of months, I'll get calls. In fact, Kim and I have done a couple of presentations on how we set up the Enterprise Fund for stormwater, what the fee's based on, how you calculate your impervious material, all that we've all done. I think there's only like 3 or 4 communities that have a stormwater enterprise fund in the state. So anyway, in that respect, we're ahead of the curve, but now now that things are coming online to what I have to do.
If you remember in January when I gave the presentation on kind of the reason Reading is the way it is financially, I didn't want to depress you anymore, but there's 2 other things. We're in the middle of major highways, so we have a certain amount of roads, but we have way more traffic on them that aren't ours. We're in the middle of 3 rivers. We have a lot more flooding. So really, it's a dumb place to have built a town. And it's especially a poor idea from a financial standpoint to have a town that's doing a good job in education. So, it's real simple. Some of it we've done ourselves, but a lot of it's just natural. We are where we are, and we just have to deal with it.
What are the reserve numbers represent?
If you look at next year, there's $800,000 of those reserves used in water, mostly to offset one capital project. You can see there's a big jump in capital right here, $1.7 million to $2.6 million. There's none needed in sewer. We happen to do a lot at November town meeting. We did this $1.2 million, and that was again an old sewer station rehab that hadn't been properly priced the year before. And then down here in stormwater, there's a big number, $250,000. You can see the expenses are going up from $400,000 to $600,000 for that year, and then projected to start approaching $1 million. And that's without knowing exactly what the regulations are, so it could be more, and probably will be more. So that's why the reserves are kind of nice to have right now, and they'll probably help us for the next 2 or 3 years anyways, and then we'll have to see after that. Because again, in the olden days with the water treatment plant, we regenerated reserves because we didn't have to pay for every bit of water we produced directly. When you buy water from the MWRA, you don't regenerate reserves that way. So we don't regenerate reserves in the enterprise funds in any natural way other than not spending money. Or someone uses a lot more water than we budgeted, and that hasn't happened. But if that would happen, we've seen a 4 or 5% increase in population, and you saw the water use still going down. So, if conservation continues, we're one of the lower ones in the state, but if it continues, it's still an upward pressure on rates.
And at this point, those are reasonable estimates of capital until we know better.
I think so. Yeah, we bumped up the sewer projects quite a bit. Water mains, you do a certain amount of debt and you do as much as you can capital-wise, basically. Are there any questions on the enterprise funds? Next, that wraps up the budget.
Any outstanding questions anybody had on budget that we haven't covered?
We're good. Okay, thanks,
Jeff.
Thanks, Jeff. You want to take like a 2-minute break?
Yeah,
that'd be great.
Sorry, just a quick question.
Yeah.
So we're talking about permits. So not the permit fund, but regular permits. So that goes into what other that we refer to?
In revenues, probably.
Other.
Yeah. Okay. Local.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, if you're interested, no, but otherwise, no.
You got it? You're not interested?
Don't strike me, too.
Give me another minute.
Yeah. And a reminder, your meeting next week for the school budget is at the Senior Center.
At 7:30.
Right. Doesn't actually cost you more, but it makes your rate go up.
It's like a fixed amount that you have to spend.
So your water bill, if you're an average person, or you're conserving more than someone else, you're paying less. Your water bill is lower. Right. But the rate keeps going higher. And everyone looks at the rate.
Right.
Figuring they're all using the same amount every year. Look at the rate. It went up 10%. Well, if you just decrease your use by 10%, guess what? That's a zero. So... But it is counterintuitive in terms of it feels like you should be rewarded
right.
for conserving, and you're seems like it feels like you're being penalized.
Yeah.
Drill a well.
Is there any update on the Birch Meadow lighting project, where that stands?
I don't remember, not that I can recall. It hasn't been spent, certainly.
Right.
And the streetlights have nothing to do with anything you were talking about. Are streetlights designed to go off and off?
I don't know. Probably not.
It was yes.
Doing it. Really?
It was done out to...
Go off. A lot.
Are kids supposed to know what time to be home?
No, so it's not.
substances before this walker.
That relates to the flicker, I think. Certainly the rate.
No, but it's interesting.
All right, let's go back in session.
There you go. Take a picture.
See if you can press the middle of the button.
Let's go through the warrant. Starting with Article 4, you have capital. And there is no net impact in the general fund, but you can see there's a few projects being rearranged, largely in facilities. And there's a decrease in FY17. So there's not a lot of action in the general fund. We tried to do that at November town meeting, and this is just cleaning up some things. Enterprise fund, none in the current year, but you can see the Grove Street water main repair that suddenly became urgent. And that's the reason we're using 800,000, which is a lot more reserves than we would have initially planned on using. None in sewer, some small changes in the future. And there's the list of capital turned into debt, if you will, in the sewer station rehabs for the future because it's too expensive to do in a single year. And stormwater, there's some of the projects with names instead of just the generic funding. We are reducing the generic funding from 125,000 down to 50, so that helps pay for one of them, but the other one has to be paid for by reserves. So you see Grove Street and Bond Street specifically as pretty urgent needs. So not a lot of action, if you will, in the capital plan, really. Article 5, lots of pluses and minuses. And you know, the question came up earlier on regeneration. We're careful in April, but we attempt to pay for the things we need, which reduces regeneration. Mm-hmm. So you'll see a lot of uses of money. Health insurance premiums, we have more than $100,000 surplus right now, so we're going to use that. This is what I mentioned last week, the disabled firefighter that still has not been allowed to retire. So there's a wage increase that fire has incurred that is rightfully philosophically a benefit. If they had been retired, he'd be, you know, being paid out of retirement.
Is there a surplus with the health insurance premiums because people are opting? Is this because of the?
That's part of it. Yes, it's an enrollment. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We didn't budget, you know, higher than the rate, so it's definitely mm-hmm. use. Mm-hmm.
Do we have time when you think this return is actually going to happen?
No, we don't.
And I guess what's held up sort of the state. That's.
And local. We have a local retirement board that's independent. I can't really assess which is more to blame, but they both are. Now, the local one tends to be faster and a little more efficient, and the state is ultra careful. I really don't know why.
But it still shows as an FTE, is that correct? So
yes.
Covering them, it's
yes.
overtime.
Right, and we can't replace that unless yeah. we all agreed. Let's yeah. go hire the replacement yes. now. Because there's still a teeny tiny chance that you know the person could come back, although in this case there isn't.
So but we're moving that money out, but we're not covering
it. We're not covering it. It's just, it's not fair to, because he's also paying overtime to cover that shift or that person.
Yeah.
It's not fair to double count yeah. is the way I look at it.
Just a question on timing. If we know this will happen at some point, and we also know that we're this close to adding a firefighter for the overtime budget as it stands, why not just hire?
Right.
Because technically the budget has not allowed that. I mean, from a cash flow standpoint, I take your point, we yeah. could, but that seems to be in bad form because town meeting hasn't approved it.
From an FTE
standpoint. From an FTE standpoint. I mean, I totally understand your point, yeah. but it seems like it's disingenuous because town meeting didn't allow for that extra firefighter. It's a good question, though.
Right, because I thought we voted dollars, not...
I guess. Yeah, yeah, it is kind of an interesting question. We also tend to try to group public safety hires if there's going to be a retirement, which isn't true in this case. But in the past, that's been one reason to slow down. No capital costs, net, just moving around. Shockingly, we had $100,000 savings in enrollment for Volk schools, and these are the two Volk schools, not our primary one in Wakefield, Minuteman and Essex North. the actual enrollment. We finally got tuition bills in February for the beginning of the school year. And until February, they couldn't tell us how many kids were there, which is always interesting. Unfortunately, the bad news is that John Doherty just processed some applications, and we won't know again until next February whether they're admitted or not, unless I followed them in my car. But the budget for next year might be about $100,000 or $80,000 too low if who has applied are admitted and they choose to go there. Not a very good system financially, I'll tell you that. As you recall, your FinCom reserves is $225,000 right now because you got an extra $75,000 for the modular classrooms. So I'm assuming you wanted to give that back. There's no real reason you need that much for the last couple months of the year.
Or you could ask.
Yeah, well, you'll vote, so.
Have we ever spent the whole 150 in recent memory before the town meeting?
You didn't have enough once. Well, no, not before town meeting, but in the June once, you didn't have enough to cover something, so we had to move health insurance for the assessors.
Okay, so but there's nothing really motivating us to say 150 isn't enough.
No, and you might even say 150 is too much if you really wanted to be conservative, but it's just going to go to free cash, so probably no reason. As we get to the bottom of this list, you might want to trim a little more, but we'll see.
We don't expect anything like last year with the modulars and the lights, like anything that's going to kind of
The biggest variable is always public safety overtime for something that happens at the end of the year.
Yeah.
There's just no way to know.
Yeah.
Each chief tries to budget at the end of the year and ask for money, even though they don't think they need it, in order to have about $50,000 extra total. You'll see we're not asking for any money this year because we think, well, we're asking for some retirement money, but we think there's 25,000-30,000 surplus now, which is close enough. If they need to come to you, they will, if something happens.
Okay.
Matt's Department Administrative Services had significant vacant positions during the year, so we're willing to part with 70,000. That leaves probably 20,000 surplus in case we need technology over time, so that's kind of a buffer. We're asking for some of that back with a whole variety of things. To have three assessment centers for the police chief and two assistant chiefs in each department is about $21,000. One of them will be held next week. It's in the write-up, but Gene didn't mention tonight that there's a new annual cost in the technology budget for human and elder services to tie into the state system, and that's both the volunteers and our patrons. And this is the one-time cost. This is effectively the license cost, the capital cost. Engineering has had some really bad luck with their technology hardware. We've had to do some emergency repairs for that we just didn't have the funds budgeted for. We're asking for $4,000 for software as a one-time cost for HR to streamline personnel reviews, and this is at least indirectly related to the new shared person that we have with schools. We're trying to automate more. In order to automate, you have to have time. Believe it or not. So now that we might have some time, it's worth doing. And then there's a small project that the town clerk had asked for in the budget last year that I said, why don't we just ask in April? $3,000 to get some vital records put in electronic form. Here's that economic development planner. We really discussed this and thought about it and decided finally that its form still isn't completely agreed to, but it would be nice if town meeting approves it to be ready to immediately act. Whether that means we advertise in advance, I feel bad about that because it's assuming an action at town meeting, but we'll at least put some money in to hire someone for the month of May and June, and most likely we won't need all of that. But just to be clear, we're asking for this out of the permits revolving fund. If it is not used, it closes to free cash. So you're moving it from one place to another, but it's a small amount.
It'd actually be nice to recruit for that position.
We've tried. then there's a couple of retirement buybacks. vacation buybacks are what they are. They're everyone that potentially could have that. But sick buybacks are all eliminated in non-union and union contracts. So these are long-term employees that were grandfathered. A series of them in finance and police. and DPW. You can see them all. And then there's a significant overlap hoped for in the town engineer's position. This is really conservative. I don't think we'll need it, but this would assume we hire a person in early to mid-April, which probably is a little aggressive.
Thank you.
Is this the end of, I ask this one every
Not
time.
Not yet. No. No, there's still some more. It's a good question. I don't think there's any left in police. There are in fire. There are none in DPW. There are probably some non-union, but that's a good question. There's certainly not very many. There's not many left, that's for sure.
It's a really long sunset.
Oh, yeah.
Well, these are 40-year employees, generally, 35, 40 years, so we're running out of them. Here's some of the fuel savings. Potentially, you know, we could do more, but we're just not sure, so we'll just remove 50,000. Snow and ice, again, as Jeff said, looks okay. When he said earlier, unless I take it, it's not because I'm going to put it in my pocket. He meant here. It's possible that there will be a surplus by, I know, exactly. There will be enough of a surplus to take some at April town meeting, but we don't want to suggest it today, just it's a little too early.
Yep.
Savings in streetlight, savings in rubbish disposal, and I'll have to figure out which one of these is right. I think 100,000 is right. I think the 80 is wrong. When you vote, you'll know.
Okay.
Here's two projects that I discussed with the selectmen last night that have not got a lot of public discussion that should. The first is a discussion between primarily the superintendent, the police chief, two police chiefs, and myself. You know, you're all aware of some of the incidents and issues that happen with schools especially, but municipal buildings. At some point, we may want to go into executive session with all the major boards in town, including FinCom, to really have a discussion about this topic. But for now, we're asking for town meeting to fund $125,000 in order to hire an independent consultant to do all the groundwork to lay out all the options for the future. Up till now, we've had a fellow who lives in town that works for a mutual fund, and as part of his community service, he's donated an enormous amount of his time to bring us up to where we are. And he's now suggested the next step is between $75,000 and $125,000 worth of consulting work. That's not a salesman trying to sell you something, so it's hard to find, but he has a couple of possibilities, and he doesn't want to do the work. This is above and beyond what he wants to do as part of community services, and he thinks we should hire an independent person that could then potentially be part of the solution or work with the vendor on that.
He has a couple of people in mind, but we'll go out to bid.
Yeah, we'll go out to bid. And again, you know, I'm obviously not going to say too much, but I will tell you right now that it's possible that the solutions that we see are in seven figures, so over $1 million.
You mentioned that last week.
Yeah.
Potentially, would it help with insurance?
Yes. Not that much, but you know, we might save 10 grand.
Per year?
To cover all school buildings or
that's
all
the question.
Buildings in general?
That's the question. We would absolutely want to know the cost of that, at least I would.
Yep.
And I'd want to know options. What's the most we could do? What's some lesser amount? What's the minimum? Well, I suppose the minimum's nothing.
But in coming up with that seven-figure number,
you'd want to, this is just like a building project, you want to really do a good upfront job of assessing all the options and pricing them properly and not get into it and find out, we didn't do enough upfront.
Probably a fixed cost, but there will be some ongoing maintenance.
Yes. Yeah, and that'll certainly be part of it is that's always, to me, one of the most important things is what's the annual cost? Because you can always afford from free cash to do something, but what is it going to cost? And do we have to hire people to maintain something? The other you're going to hear more next week, you're probably familiar, the school budget as voted by the school committee is $150,000 out of balance. This is the way it becomes balanced by moving their curriculum request into the current fiscal year. And it's depending how they do it, it's probably a three-year request. The last update I got was it's not three 150s, it goes down, but you'll have to ask them next week.
So if we're putting it into this year, then they'll still need us.
They will be able to then go out to bid right away and get it in time for the next school year, which is helpful.
Okay.
So it's the same net result for FY17. They'll have I don't remember which grades, but they have grades targeted for this new science curriculum, and then phase two, there's other grades, and then phase three is the last group.
So for phase two, they would be able to accomplish that in FY18?
They would probably do the same thing. Next, a year from this April, ask for part two money, unless there's some other plan that works better.
So is, we'll ask next week, but is the school committee then going to lower their budget request to match the number that's in the budget now? In the
town, it sort of doesn't matter.
Well, it does, except the budget presentation they have is 150 higher than.
And this is the reason, so they know that.
Revenue be like.
They've already voted a budget, they don't re-vote a budget, so. Yeah. You know, you guys are the next vote, so you just need to understand the moving parts, but this is a, you know, all transparent.
Town meeting.
Right.
Right, so. And it just has to be described at town meeting.
Right.
The other thing is they're planning on doing it next year as well. If we leave it in the budget, then they got it for next year. We don't have to.
And if it was in the budget, then you'd have to have cut $150,000 something else from the school budget or funded them higher.
But so let's just clarify for a sec. So in the town budget right now, there is the school committee's approved budget minus 150.
Correct.
That's what's in the budget. That if we didn't make any changes to it, that's what we'd vote on. That would be the number.
That's correct.
So the school committee's budget sells 150 higher. This is that 150 right here. So if our vote next 2 weeks is just for that number that's in the town budget, they wouldn't have the extra 150 in it that they could apply for later and use later in 18.
Sorry, can you say that again?
Okay, so there are, as all the budget requests come in from the different groups, it comes together through Bob into a town budget. Mm-hmm. So the school committee voted a budget, and it's, I forget what the number is exactly, but it blah, blah, blah,
yep.
Plus 150.
Yep.
Bob's budget doesn't allow for the 150, because that 150 is above the guidance that we gave. Mm-hmm. So the budget that we'll see that's in the kind of that checklist that we go through of all the line item budgets, that does not include the 150. So it's 150 below what the school committee approved.
So
but this article does cover it.
It does cover it. What I'm bringing up is this is a little confusing. I mean, it's confusing for us. It probably is going to be confusing for other people as well.
You know, it's actually, if you step back and just talk about Dr. Doherty's budgets, they've historically been $600,000-$800,000 over the FinCom recommendation, and you know then I or Peter had to balance it by cutting $600,000 or $800,000 out. Okay. It just so happens that now it's only $150,000 over, and there's a way to take care of it. But they're kind of two separate thoughts if you want to look at it that way.
Well, if we do have the opportunity, right, to approve something that is above what we had originally given as guidance.
Mm-hmm.
It seems a little bit more straightforward to do that than to approve it this way, thinking that next fiscal year we're not gonna budget for it for next fiscal year, but we think we're going to do it the same way we're doing it now and hope that we'll be able to pay for it out of reserves or whatever's in surplus. It seems like, in terms of planning, we'd be actually in a better position to do that.
And it's voted out at the same time, so would it really matter anyway?
Difference here. The big difference is if it goes through this way and it's approved at town meeting, they can go out and get started and then have it in place in time for the next school year.
Okay.
If it waits for the 18 budget,
the
17
budget. Plus, they're going to come back and ask for next year anyway. Then they don't have to come back and ask for it next year. Right.
So, I agree, but if you do that, you are imbalancing the town school budget ratio. So why are they getting it, and why didn't the town have an opportunity to ask for something? So that's why they continued and they passed a budget with that much more instead of trying to balance it, because they were trying to balance this year instead of being $600,000 or $800,000 over. But knowing they had no way to ask for this in this format as a school committee. So that's the way they asked for it. Is you remember that budget? Remember, it has $150,000 of a request that should go to town meeting in April. That's why they did it that way. And you could ask them all these questions.
Yeah, so I guess in terms of their own planning, it makes sense to ask them what their preference is next week.
Right.
Right, so time-wise advantageous. Mm-hmm. And as you say, it redistributes the basis of the budget.
Yeah, and I would argue...
it just feels like we'd be like engaging in a little bit of a budgeting fiction.
Well, but the library, you know, I don't mean to talk behind their backs, but they're home sleeping now. You know, they have 14.7% materials, $4,000 short. They could have had 15 by rearranging their own budget. I had plenty of suggestions for them on how to do it. They didn't want to. If you give them $4,000, you're encouraging departments, divisions not to balance their budget with the means available. It's as simple as that. And I don't mind. You've done it in the past, and you certainly are right, and I don't mind if you do it. But it's not something I want to encourage of the town departments to consistently ask for more than they have. And, you know, that happens in most towns, especially in decentralized towns. Town meeting has budget nights for 6 and 7 nights because that's all this is fighting over, I want this much, I want this much. And, you know, it's better to have a cohesive process, I guess. But absolutely, listen to what they say, listen to the pluses and minuses, and make up your own minds.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but if we approve this line item for this year, understanding that it's a 3-year commitment for the implementation of the science curriculum, then we're just going to be back in the same place next year, having the same discussion, because, I mean, I suppose we could cut them off next year, but it doesn't seem...
Well, they could also fashion this as part of their override request.
Or decide to not do something else in favor of this, prioritizing
right.
It would be. And, right. And I think the last piece, too, is we don't necessarily know if it is 150 next year. We should ask
right.
them next week.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
See what they're
thinking. Because I assumed it was 3 150s, and then I was told, no, it's not 450,000, it's less. So you
so
really
great.
Need
so,
to ask
yeah.
them.
So they may, in fact, have a plan
yeah.
next week.
Interestingly, the bottom line here is we only need $32,000 of free cash to balance all this. And when you think of the last two items of over $250,000, that's pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
So I would expect there to be less regeneration. I'm daring the regeneration gods yet again.
It's worked so far, actually.
It has.
Although with more positions filled, that's probably less likely.
And we're giving some of that away, but Jean's department probably will have a wage surplus. She's been able to overlap some positions in the planning department, but she had vacancies. You know, we had a lot of vacancies in administrative services. We had over $100,000 worth of vacancies there, but we're only giving back 70 because we'd like to keep 20 for technology, and they spent other money on overtime. Usually, regeneration is a combination of things, but wages aren't usually the biggest part. It's usually other things. It's usually revenues. Honestly, very small items in water, a couple of items for $70,000 that they would really like to get done now. It could easily be requested next year, but these are actually time sensitive. They want it now.
Hydrants.
Yeah, imagine that. Putting in new water mains and we need hydrants. So that's a small use of that one. The rest of the articles are really simple and straightforward. I'm really not going to plan to spend any time. There's the annual request to move money out of the budgets as they exist into the OPEB trust. That's Article 6. Article 7 is going to probably take several nights and talk about the animal control bylaw. I like the section that's called Conduct of Dogs, as if the dogs are reading them. Article 8 is the annual housing trust fund, renewal, so that's fairly boilerplate. Article 9 is the annual revolving fund renewal, and there are two changes I've underlined. It's not legally necessary, but I think it's good practice to put in that word planning, because we're talking about having an economic development planner funded out of this. Again, it's not required, but I think it's just more transparent to put that number in, or put that word in there. And then the Matera cabin and the cemetery garage have been formally taken over by the facilities department after an instructional motion at town meeting. So the facilities director should be the authority to spend this small amount of money. Not big changes, certainly. And then there's a little background for you. I know FinCom has asked in the past about revolving funds. There's not a lot of money in the town revolving funds other than that permits revolving fund. You can see them. The other revolving fund that's very active during the year is the recreation revolving fund. $700,000 or $800,000 a year goes through that, but they are required to return all of it to free cash, other than a certain amount of seed money to start the summer off. I think it's $25,000. One of the big differences is the school revolving funds do not have that requirement, and that's, I think that's a matter of state law. I don't think you can force that to happen. There's some disposal in Article 10. A lot of it's really small potatoes. Interestingly, we already declared the whole library a surplus, so they're free to do whatever they want as they move in from the temporary space. I think I mentioned this to you, that we have an invoice in the town manager's department, however that happened, to pay an April bill from last year. You know, billing companies don't know about fiscal years, so they just found it and squashed it into an invoice, and I don't know, either Paul or Caden thought and said, no, you can't do that. Article 12 is the budget, and then Article 13 is the road money. And I'll go back to Jeff's comment. I think it's important. We get about $600,000 in state money for roads, and that is what most towns spend, is only from the state. Again, because we're in the middle of a busy place, if that's all we spent, our roads would really look worse. I mean, they don't look great now. Better in the last 2 years. The last override, the only promise I remember was $300,000 to roads, indexed up 2.5% a year. So that's why we now have at least a moral obligation to spend local money on roads. We don't really have to. And I can tell you that if, you know, times got really tough, I'm sure that number would be discussed. But you saw last year when I suggested slowing down 50,000, and yes. Camille and one or two others stood up and said, no, wait a minute. So, you know, putting money in the local roads is pretty important.
And it is, but I think it's important to put it in perspective, which I thought you did tonight, because I feel like town, based on that reaction, town meeting continues to think, oh, wow, we're underfunding, we're underfunding. Because we did say that for years. I think we may need to level set and re-educate, because we're putting some good money into the roads, and
publicize that. That pavement condition index is as good a number as you can get, and we'll get a new one. I don't know what it's going to be. But when we last looked at this 7 or 8 years ago and had a target of, let's say, 80, the costs were way more than we were putting in every year for roads. So at that point, the perception and the reality were both, we're not spending enough on roads. Because we got a lot of state money, like West Street, you know, we had to pay 10%, but they gave us $5 or $6 million. So the pavement condition index now will be better. But it's gravity. You know, every year goes by, things get worse, no matter what you do. I think Jeff's right. If it was 74 before, it's probably going to be 77 now. It hardly seems like any big deal. But to move that number up is really hard. It takes a lot of money. So I take Camille's point that you don't want to give up on spending this money.
Agreed.
But also, as opposed to laying off people, are you going to start paving roads?
Right.
At some point, the answer is no.
And you need to hire people to, you know, so I think it could be a good opportunity to bring town meeting up to speed on some improvements, and we're not so negligent anymore. I think people are still thinking we're negligent.
Yeah.
Is there any possibility of doing a traffic and usage study and then basically going back to the state?
Well, the state does have a calculation that in theory gives us more state aid because of where we are, but obviously not enough. By having a lot of construction, we've discouraged a lot of cut-through traffic, so that's probably the best medicine.
it's like closing the George Washington Bridge.
Yeah, exactly.
You need to get some aids involved.
That's right. Don't do it yourself, Bob.
I'm not going to have any cartoons of me sitting on a bridge. that wraps up the warrant article, and then Mark asked me to throw a couple things in here that's just in front of you from last night's selectmen. Page 24 is a real simple look back since the last override of how we've spent money. The first column is FY03 pre-override. The override was effectively implemented in 04 and 05, I'll say. So the next best look is really 05 and 06 for post-override. And then there's the FY17 requested budget. just in four categories. Town budget, not operating, that's all in, that's accommodated costs and everything. School budget, debt and capital, and benefits. There are other things, but this is the bulk of the general fund. So that $50 million in FY03 is not the whole general fund. But if you look over time and you look in that far right-hand box, I think the reason I wanted to show this to the selectmen last night is, you know, when you start thinking about an override, you have to wonder, what is a target run rate for all these things that we'd like? Post-override, the schools in the town have run at 3.1, 3.2%. Some ups, some downs, but that's the 12 or 13-year average.
That's not bad.
Debt service and capital is negative, and benefits is positive. And quickly from the text, I've just described that because we used to do a lot of debt service inside the tax levy, we have been able to have 3.1% operating budgets because eliminating and reducing that reliance on debt has paid for health insurance. And if you go near the bottom of the page or the middle of the page and see employee benefits, excluding health insurance, benefits are up 3.3% over that period, which is pretty much the same as the schools in the town. It's health insurance. Health insurance is up, you know, 5.7 or 7% over that period. And as was discussed last night at the selectmen's meeting, because a lot of residents were there, 5 to 7% isn't affordable under Prop 2.5, but it's not that bad. And especially when you consider there's some number in there, I think it's about 1.5 to 2% a year, that's been increased enrollment. So the premiums actually are even less. You know, so you talk about, let's just say 5% health insurance premiums over 12 or 13 years, that's not terrible in the private sector. It is in the public sector when your revenues are 2 or 2.5 or 3. So the takeaway here is we've done a better job in our infrastructure. Look back to 03 before the override. We spent $25,000 in the capital plan, and $10,000 of that was the town manager's discretionary fund. So there's one $15,000 item in capital that year.
Sorry, what are you looking at?
Middle section in the box, debt service and capital.
Oh, thank you.
We spent $3.9 million on debt and $25,000 on capital. Now we have a real capital plan. We're spending $2 million next year. And again, the reduction in debt service, and it's a little harder to see because some of this debt service is excluded now. It used to all be inside the levy before the high school.
So you can't take that out?
I could, but...
Because excluded, to me,
it is different. Yeah, it is different.
Yeah.
You know, only because we had that debt service to stop doing could we afford to pay for that health insurance and keep operating budgets at 3%. Otherwise, they'd have been less. So this was just a real broad overview for the selectmen to get some sense of, okay, where have we been? How have we got here? And, you know, everyone can come to their own judgment of, has 3.1% been adequate? Maybe not quite. And then lastly, if you just jump to the bottom of the page, just kind of out of interest, water, sewer, and new storm water is about 5% a year. And I would say those are running well. The infrastructure is being maintained. Not a lot of hiring, but just, you know, paying people reasonably well. Same payment schedules. Obviously, infrastructure costs more than operating a town generally, but we also have infrastructure in the town. You know, that's our capital plan. So the answer is, you know, somewhere probably above 3 and certainly well below 5 is what you need to run the town and the schools. And that'll be a key question that the leadership of the selectmen and the school committee have to discuss in terms of what override they want, is what result do you want? And the other part of that is how long do you want the override to last for? And then the third part of it is how much extra money do you want up front to restore or add new things? Because it's probably a reasonable statement to say not enough people will support an override unless they're seeing some additions on the first year. And not, you can't just say, this will help us do the same job we're doing now for the next 10 years. You know, that's not usually how an override sells. So this exercise is, again, just meant to give the selectmen an overview.
But you would think this was, I want to say last year, about
infrastructure like water and sewer maintenance, right? You say a lot of towns ignore it and don't do it, and we've done a really good job at keeping up with it, especially lately, just which I personally think is great. But you would say there are towns that don't, and then like NWRA, I think you said, had to kick in money to maintain things on things like
well,
that.
There was a bill that our senator, prior senator, sponsored a couple years ago to allow people to join the MWRA for free. Mm. We had to pay $10 or $11 million. So that's effectively a subsidy that we didn't get.
Right.
Now, that's a little different than not taking care of your infrastructure, but the reason some communities join the MWRA is because they've done such a poor job of taking care of their own water source, whatever it was, such as a water treatment plant. Mm. There is free, not quite free, interest-free debt service now available from the MWRA to let folks do better job on their water and sewer pipes. But my general observation is, maybe not the average community, but a group of communities, especially cities, that don't spend money on it have a lot more emergencies. And sometimes they get money from the legislature to deal with a health emergency. So it's the old question is, you know, financially, purely financially, you're better off not to be proactive because someone helps you. That's not true in the private sector. You fail.
Right,
but in the public sector,
it costs
you more to be proactive, generally speaking. But do you want to take that chance that someone really will help you? That's always the question.
Right.
They always do, but what if they didn't?
Disruption can be a bigger cost than
And look at you know, lead in the water out in Michigan. At the extreme.
Yep.
You know,
yeah, at what cost?
You know, they're going to, when this is all over, they're going to have spent a lot less taking care of their water system than they should have. But they have dragged their residents through something no one should have gone through.
Absolutely.
So that's why we try to be, you know, more reasonable and spend money.
It's discouraging, though, because usually when you do things proactively, it does actually cost you less, too.
Yeah.
You know those, low-interest loans or interest-free loans? Are they eligible? Are we eligible for those?
Yeah, we're eligible for them, and we use it as well.
Okay.
Right, we've done a number of MWRA.
Okay, so that's an even playing field for that type of stuff.
Yeah, the uneven playing field is getting in for free, if that ever happened. It hasn't yet.
Okay.
But there's a lot of sentiment towards in that direction on the legislative end. And again, lastly, on the calendar, 25, 6, and 7, the important dates are October 18th is a Tuesday for a special election. September 12th, a Monday, and possibly that Thursday for a special town meeting, again, to discuss an override.
A special election meaning a special election?
Just for the override, or who knows, we might have other things, but certainly meant to be for the override.
Okay.
So take a look in May on page 26, on the Sundays there's a discussion of setting up neighborhood meetings. Not completely structured yet.
It doesn't mean Sundays, it just reminds you sometime in these weeks.
Yeah. With the goal being to get it to, at this point, the selectmen and school committee to have representatives talking to townspeople about what they want to have happen and advocate. And certainly, I mean, it's clear that all citizens can participate. FinCom's specific role is not laid out yet. I mean, you know, kind of talk through what helps. I think one of the things that, I'm talking to Paul about this, is that I think what we want to make sure of as FinCom, my opinion, is that we're helpful to the process and don't allow for a sideshow to get created for other issues. So I think we've been helpful thus far in the process. I think we'll talk about, you know, some of the materials that we've talked about here. The selectmen are talking about putting some materials together. There's a lot of discussion of getting stuff together. It probably is going to make sense to have kind of one thing go out as opposed to 15 or even two or three. So it may be that we want to kind of participate more and not necessarily be as front line as... Mm-hmm.
Can I ask one question?
Sure.
October 16, 2016, is what you anticipate
as
a special election?
18th.
I'm sorry.
October 18th, a Tuesday.
Right.
Yes.
And that would be an override question.
Correct.
Now, my other inquiry, now that occurs in fiscal year 2017?
Details to be discussed, but the expectation is it would have no impact on fiscal year 17. That's happening right now. That's what town meeting is going to vote on in a month.
Yeah, but I mean, don't you have to vote it in the...
It happens to happen in FY17, but the actual requests are very likely to be for FY18 spending.
But at the end of June 30th of 2016, you'd have an amount of unused levy capacity by whatever was voted by the override in October.
Not necessarily. It depends how the question is worded. So I'm jumping ahead a little, but I don't, I'm sorry for my back, but I don't think the selectmen intend to ask for any mid-year money.
Usually, and I made out a number of recap sheets over the years, mm-hmm. whenever it's voted, it would be recorded in the recap sheet for the year that it was voted.
It depends on the language of the ballot question. Let's pretend they say, yeah, right away, on the 19th, this is what we want. Mm-hmm. Then the selectmen will have a tax rate setting hearing, and that's where they will potentially use an extra levy amount and not assess it. If the language doesn't take care of it.
How it would appear in the statistics from the state, you'd have an unused override.
I think you're getting way ahead of the process, quite honestly.
No, I don't think so.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. All right, so what else in here?
A reminder that next selectman's meeting, you're all welcome and posted for that discussion with town council on ethics.
Give me a second. I think it would be good for us to attend.
And that's, I believe, at the senior center.
March 22nd.
Yes. Sounds like it. Yeah. Tuesday.
Yep.
I think that's all you have on your agenda.
Yeah. At 28 and 29 in here, I think we're some discussions.
I wrote down nostalgia on my outline here.
Yeah. The Excel version, I think, is a little more interesting.
This isn't the one that was selected last night. This is actually year and a half ago.
Yeah.
Just sort of a reminder of what the community wanted at the time, and again, I don't mean to speak behind the school committee's back, but this is at a time when full day kindergarten was thought to be paid for by state aid after the first year. Mm-hmm. Certainly, part of the override discussion has got to be: does full day kindergarten play a role here? Even if it's all on your nickel.
Yep.
And what's the cost?
Is as we look at kind of the capital plan, we're going to look at potential extraordinary items as well that might be thought of as part of the override. In other words, just creating a picture for people so that they say, okay, here's what's going to happen in the next X years.
You know, that's a really interesting question because, you know, I showed some really fast modeling last night, not so much to show numbers as to say the capability's there. And I actually have not given any more money to capital than you'd have if there were no override.
Right.
That's been my assumption. However, if you're going to do an override, I would assume you're going to also implicitly promise something to the voters, like we're not going to ask for a debt exclusion for some period of time. And if we know there are things like cemetery garages or DPW garages, then we better figure out a way to pay for that inside the levy.
Yeah.
So that's definitely a topic for discussion.
And it would kill them fit into that category?
Probably, yeah. $3 to $5 million, yeah. So that, you know, that's part of the unsolved why do we ask for a question.
Yeah, so last night's discussion, a lot of it was kind of structural about when would it make sense to have everything fit so that it could happen timely. And when do you have to talk to the community to be able to make it work, call the election, et cetera. But the big piece really is the what. What is it going to be? And Bob had some modeling scenarios showing possibilities. And that's, you know, the schools and the town need to get together and spend a lot of time talking about what do they need, what are they going to do. And it's got to be palatable, right? Mm.
Yeah.
So that's kind of the next step. And I would, I would imagine we can be helpful in, you know, whatever way, shape, or form to that discussion, and certainly to the outcome, because obviously, you know, clearly as it's, although it doesn't have to go through town meeting, it's been practiced to do that, and I think the selectmen pretty much said that is what's going to happen. So, you know, we'll have our involvement in that aspect of it as well.
I have another inquiry. I noticed that the override election is on the 18th, and 3 weeks from then is the presidential election.
Right.
You don't expect any backlash from that it isn't held on the presidential election day?
Actually, it can't be by law.
It can't be by law?
No.
Okay.
And to put it any closer was going to be too inconvenient for both the voters and the election workers.
No, I think maybe we'd like to move it back a little.
Well, the Board of Selectmen.
I didn't realize that it was illegal to have an override election, a presidential election.
So we want to do, before we go to minutes or anything else, any other questions, comments, where we are so far? You guys had a chance to go through the school budget.
Don't we through it?
Okay.
There's a lot there.
Yeah.
Send their questions to you, Bob?
I'll send them to John if you send them to me. Just send them to John.
I wouldn't know the answer.
Yeah.
I have his email.
Send them to me. I'll take care of it.
Yeah, I was going to say, if I was going to consolidate them, but as long as someone consolidates them, it's fine.
I just had some general questions that I was going to send out so we could have.
Yeah, I'm happy to do that.
Yeah, the sooner the better.
Yeah.
So they've got a few days to.
Okay, so who wants them?
Send them to both of us in case the beer truck comes along.
I would ask, if we were hoping to have this done for last week, so I would ask, let's, you know, set a deadline to, before the weekend. Certainly.
Yeah, Monday morning is a good deadline to give them Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday.
Yeah, I say have it in Sunday because John gets into work at 5 a.m.
4 a.m.
Probably do it tomorrow. So.
That's great.
Nice stuff, but.
Last night. And okay, so we're going to be, I'm sorry, in the senior center next week? Okay. I do anticipate we'll have a number of people joining the meeting, a number of citizens that will come to the meeting. So good that we'll be there.
Yes. So we're going to discuss the homework, quote unquote, regarding the bullets that we discussed briefly last week that Paul got.
I think
how far are we sort of shifting gears now and cooperating with the Board of Selectmen to help?
Yeah, I think the answer is both. My suggestion is that rather than kind of us publishing something that, you know, might be days in advance of whatever the selectmen are thinking about, and I'm sure the schools too, we might be better helping facilitate a process to get some materials pulled together. And then also when we meet on the 22nd with town council, I think we may learn some things about what can and can't happen also that'll be helpful to this discussion. I've been asked by a number of people where these things are, when they're going to get published. And what I said to them is that we're going to have this meeting on the 22nd, and that may define a lot of things. But certainly there wouldn't be anything before then that's finished. But to your point, if we've done homework, we should. At some point, we need to figure out what's the best way to present. I was telling Bob earlier, I thought a lot of the stuff he did for last night and even the week before was great and very helpful, explaining things and kind of creating a story. From our perspective, I want to just make sure it's very factual, but completely factual, and not opinioned, I guess is the right word. I don't know, maybe. but that's what it's got to be. And just so that people can have, if we created that factual base of information, we the town or whatever groups, then people can debate back and forth on, you know, are they for it or against it. That's fine and dandy. But it'd be great to just have this core of information. Is that?
Yeah, and just so you're aware, you know, we knew there'd be interest in the override as a topic, but when we had informally laid out a timeline, we didn't expect the selectmen last night to be needing to vote to set an election. That's pretty fast. Yeah. We were all in the middle of the FY17 budget, but based on the residents, obviously it was the right thing to do. On top of that, we had an election. It ended up being uncontested, but generally, when the boards change and when the leadership changes, you don't do a lot of things before the end. Well, Beacon Hill does, but we don't. So what I'm saying is last night the selectmen elected a new chairman. Now that chairman and the chairman of the school committee and John and I have already set up every 2-week breakfasts. So we're working as a group of four, and we'll expand that one or two if we need to work out a lot of policy issues for both boards. And we've invited the library. I don't really know what their interest is. I assume they'll be interested. Mm-hmm. And then at some point, it then grows beyond policy and includes FinCom. So we'll undoubtedly include one or two FinCom members and grow the group a little bit more and talk about things like communications.
Who's the new chair?
John Halsey. And Kevin Sexton is the vice chair.
Okay.
And the schools are going to remain the same until after the graduation. So Chuck is still the chair. And four of us already met once. Dan, as the outgoing chair, did meet with Chuck. I think we had breakfast last week to just sort of lay the groundwork for the next group of four. Mm-hmm. These are the things that need to be discussed. Things like, what do you want to tell the public the override lasts? How many years? Mm-hmm. What kind of, instead of asking how much you can afford or how much do you think they'll go for, what's the outcome that's desired? Mm-hmm. What's the goal for an operating budget? Mm-hmm. And then the third part is, what are the things that need to be identified as, well, if you don't do this, we have to cut this, or if you do this, this is what we can add. Mm-hmm. And that's the hardest part, probably, especially the cut part. So that's the basic framework we're at. And what I showed the selectmen briefly last night is discouraging. You're not going to get more than a 3 or 3.5% operating budget unless you do more than a 15% override for 10 or 12 years. So
15% override.
Sorry. Yeah, I knew he was listening. No comment.
That's what I thought I heard.
There was a lot of scenarios listed at the selectmen's meeting last night, all the way from 0 to 15.
Okay. Well, not 0 to 15.
So these are the kinds of discussions that need to happen as to what are we trying to accomplish. And then the question will be, what do you think we can achieve? And that's where, FinCom will be brought in. What's been made very clear to both the school committee and the selectmen is whatever override amount that's requested will not solve all the nice-to-haves that the community has on its list. And that has to be made very clear because, there's 25,000 people with 25,000 things they'd like, and they can't all think they're going to get what they want if they vote for an override because it's not affordable. But there has to be some core of things that a majority would want, whether it's an addition or the lack of a subtraction. So we want to make sure we're very transparent to the community and no one looks back and says, I didn't understand.
How do you judge what the majority wants?
Well, that's part of the neighborhood meetings. Yeah. John will use town meeting with the clickers, and we haven't figured out what to ask yet, but we'll figure that out and get a start. And we may do the same in all these neighborhood meetings, is bring those voting devices. Hope we have enough. We have 225, or 200.
I think one of the things we should be very careful of in using those devices is to use language that's easily and well understood. I think that we didn't necessarily do as good a job as we could have at the last town meeting. Talking about percents and things like that.
We didn't have a context.
Yeah, well, yeah, it, exactly. Just, yeah. It was, you look at what it feels good. Itself, and it's like,
So that would work in that process. I mean, I think I was at last night's town meeting, Board of Selectmen meeting. Paula was there. I'm encouraged that things, that we have a calendar, that things are moving forward, and there's a lot of discussion going on. There were a good number of citizens in the room as well, participating in the discussion and asking questions. And a lot of their questions were when, and then I think the selectmen decided to answer that part of it, so that was good.
Another question, was that just a tentative discussion? There was no formal vote taken?
There was a formal vote.
It was a formal vote. I didn't read the paper this morning. Was it in there?
I doubt it.
Wasn't
I don't think anyone was covering it.
Didn't end until 11 something.
Only Paul was covering the meeting.
I'll be in tomorrow.
So what I was just, Vanessa, it sounds like you may have put together some materials.
Sure.
Sorry?
I did, actually. But I'll hold, given.
Yeah, I think that it would be really helpful is to figure out, you know, what data is going to make the most sense. And again, I think some of the stuff that Bob had here was actually very, very helpful. And then to help shape it into a very manageable document. And I think that, again, one document, I think, makes a whole lot more sense than multiple. So let's decide what we want to do about that, because we've got some homework. I took one more pass at the free cash thing. Free cash thing, unfortunately, doesn't get shorter.
I know.
Yeah.
I thought the more time you had, the shorter things got.
Churchill.
Yeah. That's who it was. Yeah.
I didn't have time to write you a short letter,
right.
So
yeah,
it was a long one.
Yeah, yeah. I made the mistake of reading some more information about what the definition of free cash, and that just got bigger and worse. So what do we want to do with those things? I think we definitely do want to at least have a discussion and then use that as the bait, as a way to help the other groups. I just think we need to work with the other groups, otherwise it's not going to move forward very well.
How do you think that process will happen? I guess that's kind of what's happening in my mind. Like, how, obviously, you know, we've had discussions here that I know are vital to the overall discussion, or I believe they're vital to the overall discussion. So what do you think the forum will be to shape that discussion?
I think we've got to wait to the 22nd.
I agree.
To figure out.
Okay.
I think we've collectively started with a lot of information. I think we should hang on to it until we know. Because I think there's too many paths. We can spend time right now going down a bunch of different paths that may or may not be available to us. And
sure.
Yeah. I emailed everybody Bob's summary that he published last week, maybe.
So it's two-page thing?
The two-page thing. Yeah, and it's part of the...
Your community connection.
Right. So, I mean, that's a starting point for, you know, some discussion points that are available and out there. So I think that's a good start. I think we certainly can't publish before having the 22nd discussion.
Yeah.
That can't.
No, you got to vote on the FY17 budget first.
But I think we've done stuff that's good. We should find a way to at least put it together into, and you know, it's not something to be published at this point, but at least it's going to be some information, and then the 22nd starts to inform a little bit more about kind of the how. And then I think we want to coordinate it so that there's, again, one document that ends up being the kind of the master fact sheet. Does that make sense? Any?
I agree.
Great.
Makes sense.
Yeah?
Yeah, I think it might make sense to add it to the agenda or at the end of the meeting on the 23rd after we voted on the budget, to kind of take stock of what we learned at the meeting the night before. And what
make
that how that gives us direction going forward.
Yeah,
that sounds great.
Good idea.
And then maybe we have one more meeting in
March.
Right,
but we probably want to do it in conjunction.
I think in April you probably want to meet before town meeting. Just to discuss old people, right?
Are we scheduled for the end?
You're not scheduled for the last day in March.
Okay. All right. So
whatever day that is, 30th.
Yeah.
Well, that's an extra day in case you needed it.
Right.
I don't think you need it for the override discussion anyway.
You don't have a meeting
it's the last
after the 23rd until May?
You don't have one scheduled till June, whatever, but obviously this year you're going to add some. But normally, after this March set, you just have a year end. But I'm sure this year you're going to want to add one or two.
Do we want to look at the 6th or the 13th of April?
When's the school vacation is?
I don't anymore.
April?
Yeah.
It's
the week of the
18th. 15th. Yeah, I leave the 15th, so it's that week after the 15th.
I'm going the
6th.
It's the week of the 18th,
yeah.
The
22nd.
Yeah,
gotcha. So how does the 13th look for folks?
I'm
Thomas Jefferson's birthday.
Is it something we want to kind of pull, but not... I'm just wondering, based on what we learn and what we hear on the 22nd, if we then have a better sense of...
You can certainly set a date on the 23rd, really.
Yeah.
And you'll have a better sense. Maybe you want to meet a few times.
Yeah. I would suggest we block the 13th for now, though,
yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah.
And just put it on calendars, and let's post ourselves for here. And then we can adjust as needed. And then what we should probably do on the 23rd is make sure that we add this to the agenda.
What's that?
This is Thomas Jefferson's birthday.
Exactly.
Bring a cake.
He'll be proud. Okay. Any other business before minutes?
Well, this is a bigger question. So in spring town meeting, we don't do any overviews or state of the town.
Yes.
Well, it's more a thing like the state of the town. Like
well, the chairman of the selectmen will go first, and then the finance committee person, some years, not every year, has gone second.
Oh, yeah, and I was meaning we is bigger than we, not just FinCon. Just because we're often struggling with tooting our own horn, we don't. And we're talking about some of the community service projects. It'd be so effective to have a little video of, you know, oh, someone in the senior center. Oh, I'm so grateful for it. And, you know.
It's not in their DNA, but I didn't know exactly what you mean.
Right. But as I'm hearing some of those programs, I'm like, I don't know.
Wouldn't this be a cool high school project? You got 30 days, 40 days, whatever it is.
And who doesn't want to sit here back and watch a video first? No offense to anyone, but.
We'll have all this free airtime when the political campaigns are done.
But we don't toot our own horn. We have so many programs that people have no idea, and it costs money to support them. And you hear them, and you go, you know what? I don't take advantage of that program, but it's a great program.
You don't always want them to know, because that costs more money.
No, it's that we should promote.
Yeah, I think
we need a little.
Well, I'll be honest with you. There's things out there that
time.
We do that if we don't get an override in the next year or so, we're going to have to stop doing.
Right,
so
people don't even know we have a program.
There's a fine line there. We need to educate them about its existence, but not necessarily get people hooked on something that can't continue.
Well, they might
but they won't, they won't
they
vote
to,
for an override if they're not.
I know.
Yeah.
I know. We're careful about that, though. When you're dealing with the fragile population, we do a certain amount for them as best we can. But that's an infinite potential. You could always do more.
Right. Some of it's a permitting process. Okay. Some of the improvements
easy.
We've made.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But
that stuff's
in
easy.
A video format, I would just come
well,
across.
I'll tell John Halsey that's the way he has to deliver the State
exactly.
of the Union message. That's all.
Exactly.
Yeah, and I think we'll at least coordinate the messages a little bit between Selectmen and FinCom just to make sure that they're not either identical or
handy that you live near each other.
Yeah, shouldn't be a problem.
Figure that out.
Okay, should we go to minutes?
Yes.
I make a motion.
Wait a minute. On January 20th, on page 3, fourth paragraph. It says you noted that OPEB's going to be fully funded by 2029.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is. Okay. Good thing someone reads the minutes.
Pension.
Not OPEB.
Are you going to change it? Maybe fully funded?
Yeah.
Or you want to say it will be more fully funded?
What's the context? Because the enterprise funds, that would be true.
Breakdown. Pension OPEB, which I noted, $3.5 million for the pension, $500,000 for OPEB. He also noted in 2029, OPEB will be fully funded.
That would be true for the water, sewer, and stormwater and RMLD, but it probably meant pension. They're on the same schedule.
So you want to make it more fully funded?
I just change OPEB to pension and leave it at that.
Pension. Pension. Okay. So sorry, we have a motion. We have a second?
Second.
Any comments? Any changes? All right, all in favor? Opposed? We're 9-0. And second one.
It's harsh.
Did I see that? Cross that right out. Paul's mad dudes at home.
motion to accept the minutes of February 10th.
We have a second?
Second.
Comments? All in favor? Opposed?
Abstained.
Abstained. I'm sorry. 7-0-2. Any other business, guys? Next week? No? I would entertain a motion.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor? Opposed? 9-0-0. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Until next week. Any comments, please send them along to me. Yep.